Sorry, I have feedback from my computer there. Good morning and welcome to the 10th meeting of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee in 2023. I've not received any apologies for today's meeting. The first item on our agenda is to decide whether to take items 6 and 7 in private. Are members agreed? We're agreed, thank you. And the second item on our agenda is the first in a series of scrutiny sessions with all the NHS boards in Scotland. And for this morning's session, a welcome to the meeting, Rafe Roberts, the Chief Executive of NHS Borders, and Cathy Cowan, the Chief Executive of NHS Forth Valley, joining us remotely, although not quite at the moment, but we should be expecting Claire Burden, who's the Chief Executive of NHS Ayrshire and Ireland. So I'll kick things off. Thank you for coming in today. By no means, but we're not selecting you specifically. We're going through. Sandesh, sorry, I forgot to go to you. Sandesh, on you go.
Thank you, Convener. I just would like to put onto records a declaration of interest that I have worked in NHS Ayrshire and Arran and NHS Forth Valleys previously and currently.
Thank you. That's now on the record. As I said, we're not singling out any particular boards. We're just methodically trying to fit in a session with every board as we continue over the next couple of years. So I would like to ask both of you just now about the financial sustainability. I'm particularly interested in how the inflation is affecting you and the increased cost of fuel. I think people often forget, we tend to talk about these things in domestic terms, internally in the media, that seems to be how it comes out about how it's affecting families. And obviously that's going to have an impact on you in terms of people needing your care. But in terms of your operations, I'm interested to know about your financial sustainability and the impact of inflation and fuel costs is having on your board at the moment. So, Rafe, I'll come to you first.
Thank you, Convener. Yeah, I mean, it is a very significant issue. I mean, the overall position around financial sustainability is extremely challenging, and we can get into more detail around that, obviously. In terms of inflation and cost of living, I think the point you make about the impact that has on our patients, but also our staff, is a important issue that we're hearing about. But in terms of our costs, it is certainly having an impact. You'll have seen from the draft financial recovery plan that we've submitted to the committee that our financial position has deteriorated over the last couple of years and going into next year. And a part of that is inflation. I think the figure, I need to double check it completely, I think we're projecting about £1 million more in energy costs going into next year. So it is not an insignificant figure. I'll maybe need to just double check that and make sure I'm absolutely quoting the right figure. But it's also not just energy costs, it's procurement costs across the board. Prescribing costs are going up. Some of that's to do with activity, but I've no doubt that there'll be underlying cost pressures within the supply chain for medicines as well. So I think we have to recognise it is a very, very significant factor. And the reality is that that is not matched by the general uplift that health boards have had over the last couple of years and going into next year.
Cathy.
So, like Rafe, financial sustainability and value, we've pulled two together, is extremely challenging. We are, however, reporting a break-even position for 2022-23. And our three-year plan that we've shared with you highlights over that period the areas that we'll focus on. So our big focus will be in inequalities and trying to shift that resource into prevention through primary and secondary interventions and transformation. In relation to inflation, we obviously have a unitary charge issue in relation to our three big estates, so Forth Valley Royal Hospital, Clackmannanshire and the Stirling Care Village. So that's linked to the retail price index, and when inflation goes up, that goes up. So we will see an increase of about £5.2 million absolutely in alignment with inflation. Energy costs, we are projecting a 30% increase. I don't have the exact figure, just like Rafe. I'd like to check that out. But 30% is the increase that we have in our plan. medicines, again, subject to inflation. And in terms of cost of living, like Rafe, our staff are feeling that in terms of fuel costs and our patients. And we're keeping a very close eye on our patients, and in particular, our did not attend rates, just in terms of if we're seeing trends within communities and so on.
So you're actually monitoring maybe the impact that the cost of living crisis might be having, people presenting to you, as well as perhaps like staff absences and
particularly patients. And our Director of Public Health is actually looking at particularly is that linked to deprivation categories and so on, mm-hmm. so that we can have some more insight. And also to think, how can we work in partnership with councils and so on to help our patients get to hospital, and think about how we take services to our patients.
Yeah, that's really interesting. I mean, are you doing a similar thing, Rafe, in terms of actually trying to ascertain how this is impacting on your patients?
Yeah, we're trying to, and our public health department are sort of looking again at how they run their services and what support they can put in, how they provide greater resilience in communities. Not so much focusing on individuals, but in a broader sense, how do we build resilience in the communities?
Yeah, thank you. And I would have gone to Claire Burden, but she's not, doesn't seem to be online yet, so I'll just keep going. I'll throw over to my colleagues now. Paul Sweeney, you have some questions for our panel.
Yeah, thank you for that. I think the main interest I have is on capital investment and how that can be used to actually drive revenue savings in the National Health Service overall. I'd be just interested to know what your boards have done in terms of considering how to utilise capital investment as a way of reducing revenue costs, particularly of utilities, through the introduction of investments in things like district heat networks. I know, for example, there's a good model at the Golden Jubilee Hospital where they've recently introduced the Queen's Quay District Heat Network Scheme, which is in partnership with Western Bartonshire Council, that stands to deliver a major cost saving to the hospital estate, as well as potentially benefiting the wider community in terms of getting them off the gas grid by using the River Source District Heat Network. I just wonder whether that kind of model, in terms of a high return on investment capital programme, could potentially be a way of kind of conquering this current challenge of high costs in terms of utilities.
So certainly in our acute hospital, we're looking at every opportunity to reduce energy costs, and I don't have the exact figures in front of me, but we did get a grant from Scottish Government that we're implementing so that we're actually reducing the costs, particularly around lighting and heating and so on. So that we're taking every opportunity to do that. We're also investing significantly, as you would expect, in car charging and so on in all of our sites to actually help both staff and patients. So very, very committed to it. Don't have the exact figures in front of me, I apologise for that, but very happy to share the schemes that we're doing.
That would be helpful. Just also be interested to know, do you have like a slate of proposed capital investment schemes and an actual formula that would tell you what your expected return on investment would be?
Again, we do, and certainly to the board, we take our capital plan and we go through a whole series of kind of analysis around how we use rooms, how we heat rooms and so on, and where we would invest and what would be the return on that in terms of benefits realisation. So we do have that. I don't have it in front of me, but very, very happy to share it with committee members.
Okay, that's definitely helpful. Thank you.
Thank you, Paul. Emma Harper.
Thanks very much. I suppose just on the back of that, about investments and in, I suppose, money saving for energy, for instance, NHS Dumfries and Galloway have a £200 million hospital and they didn't put a single solar panel on the roof. Is that something that has been assessed in NHS Borders, for instance, or in other areas to look at that kind of opportunity for whether accommodation could be made for that kind of investment in solar panels, for instance?
We're certainly looking at energy efficiency projects in a variety of different ways, and that will be part of them. I think we need to recognise, going back to the previous question, district heating systems. I was used to having been in Shetland in my previous job, and that was part and parcel of the approach there. The hospital was on the district heating system, but those systems are not that common. There would be no opportunity in the borders. There just isn't that infrastructure locally for us to do that. But we are looking at other forms of energy efficiency. Our plan for next year has savings of about £390,000 assessed as potential from a variety of energy efficiency schemes. In the longer term, we will be looking to refurbish and replace our District General Hospital in the long term, and I'm talking about, you know, 10, 15 plus years, because I think the other bit that we are very conscious of is that the overall availability of capital is quite restricted. We have a formula allocation of capital for minor schemes, and the vast majority of that we have got allocated to equipment replacement, infrastructure, maintenance, and some of the sort of energy efficiency schemes. But we are going to have to build long-term business cases for more fundamental redesign of our estate.
Okay, thanks.
I just want to bring you both back before I move on to other colleagues, and I'll bring Paul in a second. Now, the uplift that you got from Scottish Government effectively was for you to be reducing waiting times, and I imagine that a certain amount of recovery from COVID. But yet you have mentioned it was not there to be dealing with things like fuel costs and inflation, because at the point at which it was decided, that wasn't as acute as it is right now. It's an obvious question, and but I suppose it's almost a rhetorical question, but I'm asking you for your assessment of effectively how those two factors that we've been talking about before are affecting your ability to deal with your waiting times.
Can I? Our uplift is there to address the broad range of costs that we have and how they change from one year to the next. I think it's fair to put on record that in addition to the core uplift we get, we have had a commitment that going into next year, the additional cost over the basic level of uplift that we've got for the pay awards will be funded separately. So I think it's important that we recognise that. The money we get for access waiting times, it normally comes as a separate allocation, and we've got our, for borders, we've got our NRAC share of the waiting times money for next year, which is just over £2 million, and I think the breakdown of how we were suggesting we would be spending that was included in the pack that we submitted. I think the other bit though that is really important to recognize when we talk about the financial challenge is that there is no doubt finances are challenging, but equally challenging is the workforce position. And if you go to the sort of headline figure in Borders financial plan, which is a projected overspend next year in the order of £22 million, the reality is if you gave me an additional £22 million tomorrow, I couldn't spend it because I wouldn't be able to recruit the staff. So when we look at the challenges around access, it is as much, if not more, about our ability to attract the workforce that we need going forward and our ability to create the capacity in the system as a result of that workforce that allows us to protect our elective programme rather than purely the money.
Yeah, a number of the colleagues are going to look into staffing as well, but that's a really good, helpful basis for that discussion. Cathy, I'll bring you in.
So very similar to Rafe. So our uplift, a 2% uplift, which equates to about £12.4 million, and then our NRAC share of £0.6 million has been added to our baseline of £630 million. We have in-year allocation just over £108 million to come in, so we've factored that into the plan that we've shared with you. As Rafe says, workforce is a big, big issue. We took a decision 21-22 to invest in a recurring workforce, and actually that's benefited us in terms of our scheduled care position. You'll see our scheduled care position is actually reasonable compared to other areas, but still a long way to go in terms of the patients waiting.
And by doing that, it's gave us that kind of advantage. We took that decision based on a risk-based approach about allocations coming in non-recurringly year on year. And rather than using that money non-recurringly, we decided to actually invest recurringly and took that decision. And that's paid dividends for us. But as Raif says, we're now really all looking for a workforce together, and that workforce is very short in particular key areas.
Thank you. And I won't impinge on my colleagues who want to come in on staffing, particularly Paul.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning to the panel. I think just to follow on the issue that was raised around people attending inappropriately, if you like, I just wonder to what extent, I mean, within the recovery plan, there was an ambition to reduce hospital as the first port of call by 15 to 20% in terms of that review of urgent care. Although Audit Scotland have highlighted that there has been a lack of progress on that. So I wonder, the first question, I suppose, is are you tracking people who attend A&E as the first port of call and it's not the appropriate setting for them, I suppose, is the first part? And secondly, what impact do you feel those attendances are having on the overall budget?
I think, so my background is nursing and I did work in the emergency department a very long time ago, and I'm just a bit cautious about people attending inappropriately. I think certainly in Forth Valley we are very, very keen for patients who could have went elsewhere to redirect, but also to provide support and education so that the next decision that they make is the right decision, so the right place, right time, right personnel and so on. Because I really worry about particularly older people who hear messages about we're really busy, and these are the patients that usually don't turn up, and I would suggest these are the patients that should turn up. So we're really taking an approach that is very measured, and in terms of our triage system, when so people present to the emergency department, we are very clear about a primary triage where we will quickly go through that and say this patient could actually go elsewhere, they could go to pharmacy, they could go to the MIU in Stirling or whatever, and do that redirection and education, and particularly with mums and young babies about what else is there. And then we have a secondary triage so that people are very, very quickly moved around the department to meet their need. And I think the 4-hour emergency access standard, which is a system measure, is only half of the story, even half. And behind that measure is a number of very critical safety measures. So Raif and I, as chief executives, will watch very carefully our time to triage. So when that starts to creep up over 15 minutes, there is a safety alert within our systems, which would actually think, what do we do next? So I say that in answer to your question about redirection. There are people who are repeat offenders in terms of that turning up where they could go elsewhere, but it's an approach where we're really trying to educate the public in our own space and look to national campaigns to support that. I hope that's helpful.
I would certainly echo everything that Cathy has said, I want us to understand slightly better what is going on, because if you look at the overall numbers, certainly within our system, the overall numbers coming through our emergency department are only just back at pre-pandemic levels, if slightly under. And I think that actually suggests that a number of patients are now being seen elsewhere in the system. And the ones who are coming in to our emergency department are the ones who absolutely need to be there. We've got flow navigation centres, we've got our... So that sort of primary care bit at the front door, I think, is streaming out some patients. There is no doubt, certainly the data I've seen, although it's not as good as I would have wanted it to, that the level of activity in primary care is higher than it was pre-pandemic. So I think we are making progress in making sure people are seen in the right place. Our front door clinicians don't say to us that they are seeing a lot of patients that they would say were inappropriate. But I think, as Cathy says, the challenge for us or our responsibility is to make sure when they do come into the front door that we triage them, and where appropriate, we turn them around and signpost or move them on to other services, or where appropriate, we treat and discharge, or where appropriate, we assess and admit and then treat, obviously.
Thank you, Paul. We will move on now to just talking about performance. We've already touched on it anyway. Paul Sweeney.
Yeah, just wanting to know, like, you've mentioned it already about A&E presentations, for example, but the Scottish NHS, or the Scottish healthcare system, has the highest acute hospital expenditure in any OECD country, but the lowest preventative community-based expenditure of any OECD country. So it seems like an equation that's very lopsided. But even within that, there are metrics which are quite worrying about low provision, for example, of key diagnostic equipment per capita, beds per capita, etc. Are these metrics that you tend to keep track of? So, for example, provision of MRI or CT scanners per capita relative to international benchmarks? Is that something that your boards monitor as an active metric?
I suppose we don't probably measure it in that way in terms of our service. We do, we're very conscious of the level of capacity we've got in our diagnostic services, and part of our access plan for next year is to bring in additional CT and MRI capacity on a mobile basis. We have also just gone through a process of replacing our MRI, and we're due to replace our CT scanner next year so that they are up to date. So I suppose we focus on it in terms of the capacity and the demand in our system, rather than particularly looking at a population basis. And I suppose that, to some extent, is as a relatively small population, then that will be skewed, if you like, if we just looked at it purely on a population basis. Mm. So certainly diagnostics is an area we are very conscious about. We believe we've got a very good record of performance in terms of our cancer targets, and a key aspect of that, obviously, is the diagnostic stage in that cancer pathway. So we have an awful lot of focus on that and ensuring that we've got the capacity in place to deliver against the targets.
Okay. Just jumping to the other end of the patient journey, if you like, within the acute hospital setup, do you track actively the opportunity cost of the delayed discharge issue in hospitals, and you know what impact that has on overall capacity to deliver community-based services? Is there almost a reflex situation where delayed discharge in turn is denying opportunities to invest in more appropriate care settings?
There's no doubt, from my point of view, that delayed discharge is a very significant issue. We monitor that on a daily basis, of where our delayed discharges are, what they're waiting for. And it is a whole system responsibility. So this isn't just about social care. This is about the way in which our clinicians make decisions, the way in which we support people through the system. But we're sitting at something like 30% of our beds in the borders currently occupied with delayed discharges. If you go back to pre-pandemic, we probably ran somewhere around 20 delays at any one time, and we felt that was too high at that point, because in a sense every single delay is about an individual receiving care in the wrong place, notwithstanding the impact it has on the system. That is about an individual not getting the care that they need at the right time in the right place. We have been running anywhere between, well, upwards of 50. Yesterday we had 68 delayed discharges in our system. So that is a huge opportunity cost. The consequence of that for us is, one, the impact that then has on our ability to have elective capacity. But the other issue that has caused for us is it has increased our overall length of stay, along with a number of other issues. And it has required us to open additional beds, which we have struggled to staff, and that's had a knock-on impact. So as of yesterday, we had 15 additional beds open in the hospital. That was 20 up until last week. And we've had 8 additional spaces opened and staffed, or at least we aim to staff in our emergency department to reflect the fact that we've got additional people in our system. So It is a very fundamental issue.
It certainly is, as you observe, but is there any viable mechanism that you envisage to how you unravel that back into a more sustainable approach? As it seems to be very much it's wrapped up in a self-perpetuating cycle at the moment. How do we recover the situation?
I mean, I think for me, there's two issues. One is ensuring within the health system we are making the right decisions at the right time to support people through their treatment programme and the point at which we make decisions around what sort of support they will need going forward, recognising that we discharge well over 90% of our patients without any delays. So I think it's important that we remember that. And we've done quite a lot of work recently in the last 6 months around focusing on that continuous improvement of our individual processes. There are issues in there around realistic medicine or value-based medicine, whatever phrase you want to use, in terms of the choices clinicians are making with patients around the level of treatment that is appropriate to their needs and not being unrealistic about that. But beyond that, there is no doubt that, in my mind, that there is an issue around the level of social care support that we've got. And I recognise and have a lot of conversations with our social care colleagues that a large part of the driver around that is the recruitment and retention issues that exist within social care. And we have to address that as a health and care system.
Okay, that's helpful.
Just really, though, to repeat everything that Rafe said, I mean, yesterday in our system, we had 93 delayed discharges. And on top of that, we had just over 50 transfer waits. So it does have a huge impact, particularly the acute site, and it does have a huge impact on our four-hour emergency access standard, because that is a system measure. So that does have implications. And within those figures, we have about 33 patients with AWI capacity issues that we're just thoughtful about how do we actually support families through that decision-making process. But equally, I wouldn't want you to think that we're not investing in prevention or indeed community care, because alongside that, similar to Rafe and other NHS boards, we have been particular about investing in respiratory pathways and community teams so that we're actually treating patients at source in terms of them presenting to hospital. We've put a big emphasis on the outpatient parental antimicrobial therapy. So again, we're doing that in the community. We have really focused on a kind of rapid assessment and care unit, so that's a different front door if you present at the hospital, so that we're redirecting ambulance and so on through that to treat patients with long-term conditions, heart failure. We want to do a very quick and really thorough diagnostic assessment so that we can actually support people in the community. So our whole system approach to this is very much about prevention. I think the thing about prevention is it takes a while to see it coming through, but it's absolutely the right thing to do. And we've seen coming out of COVID, and we've still got lots of COVID around. You know, we've got 40 plus patients in the acute site today. But one of the things that we're very keen to do is to actually focus on how do we support an infrastructure that actually takes account of those patients who didn't present during COVID with high blood pressure and so on. So some of the kind of secondary prevention around diabetes, for example, around hypertension. And I think some of the acuity that we're seeing in the acute site, I agree with Rafe, the patients that are presenting are acutely ill, and I think we're seeing that, and we're desperately trying to sort that, but also think about prevention going forward.
Okay. If I may, convener, just want to ask about preventative. You mentioned about preventative spend, but also preventative maintenance. We know that certainly in some health boards there are severe repair backlogs on capital investments, which can end up becoming far more expensive over time if they're not preventatively tackled. Is this a challenge in your health boards? Do you have a repair backlog that is concerning? Is it a risk that you see to be significant? Or how are you approaching preventative maintenance?
So in our health board, we're actually fortunate, although unfortunate in terms of the conversation that we had earlier about inflation and the retail tax price and so on. But we've got one facility in our community hospital estate in Falkirk, and some Belsdyke issues as well, where we have got up to about £30 million backlog. We're addressing that through our capital spend, making sure that our decisions are such that we're using our estate really appropriately. And the other big area that we're looking at as a whole system with local authority and so on is our primary care infrastructure. Because if we're really serious about supporting services in the community, what does our primary care infrastructure have to look like? And some of our primary care facilities are really outdated, and we've got a programme of investment, notwithstanding what Rafe was saying about capital in terms of business case development, but actually a programme of investment to actually turn those facilities round. And again, looking with councils about, is there things that we could do jointly to actually use the public purse in a way that adds value?
Okay. Yeah, I must move on, Paul. There's a lot of members wanting to come in, and I just can I let members know that Claire Burden has now arrived. She had some significant connection issues, so good morning to Claire. I won't bring you in immediately and try to make you catch up with everything that you've not heard. But if you can maybe just put an R in the chat box if there's anything that you want to come in specifically, but I'll leave members to bring Claire in. Gillian.
I think in the interest of time, convener, my question on this theme has probably been adequately covered, so you can move on.
Thank you. Emma.
Thank you. It's just a kind of a supplementary question on the back of what Paul's asking about CT scans being available or additional capacity prevention aspects in the community. On Friday, Rafe, when we met at our usual elected members' briefing, you talked about how beds are used as a currency instead of maybe what we should be looking at is the services that are delivered, like pulmonary rehab or mental health in community now, which prevents acute admissions, for instance. So there's a lot of work being done looking at how we deliver things differently. I heard about a diabetes outreach bus that's being developed in Glasgow by Dr. Brian Kennan, where they'll go to Ibrox Stadium, for instance, and help do some of that kind of health inequality outreach for type 2s. Is that something that you think we should be focused on, as like not just looking at beds as a measurement of how successful things are? We should be looking at service delivery. Is that something that you would like to comment on?
I mean, as I said on Friday, I absolutely think we have to look at that. If you look at the way healthcare has evolved over the last, my career, 30-plus years, it is completely different now. So when the Borders General Hospital was built, it had an ophthalmology ward. We don't admit patients on an inpatient basis for ophthalmology now. It's nearly all done on a day case basis, and healthcare continues to evolve in that way. As Cathy referenced, we're looking at virtual respiratory pathways, we're looking at hospital at home. In addition to the delayed discharges that are sort of formal delays in terms of the way we currently measure them, a number of times a year, we'll do an exercise to look at all of the patients in our hospitals and what their needs really are. And from that, we can see a very significant proportion, well over 30% up to, towards 50% at times, are people who actually could be cared for in a different way. So I think we need to look very differently at that. In the Borders, we've got four community hospitals, one of which is relatively new, was opened in the early 2000s. The other three go back to 1950s and pre that in terms of age. So going back to that backlog issue, that they are a significant issue in terms of maintaining the standards. But if you look at the way we're using those, there are very different alternatives that could be put in place in terms of supporting in people in the community, which is not about a traditional hospital. So I think we've got to change the dynamic around that and not get hung up on, is this a hospital bed? It's about what is the need that individual patient / person in the member of our population actually needs. And I think there are very different ways we can approach that. Some of the examples you've used, some of the other examples, and looking at a different way of providing care in the community. Our local council have been looking at care villages and are in the process of developing business cases for two care villages, and I think that will change the way in which we provide support in the community for people on a long-term basis.
Okay. I suspect that my other questions will come up later, but I can pause there.
Opportunity to bring in Claire from NHS Ayrshire and Arran. Claire, I mean, we've been talking this morning about financial sustainability, and I think it's only fair to bring you in just to ask your assessment of how your health board is managing your finances and balancing your budgets given the current strains on your finances.
Thank you and good morning. Apologies, I, along with my ICT challenges, I have a voice challenge with the local cold. So my apologies for that. I inherited a deficit of 26 million, and we have been unable to chip into that deficit over the last year. Very much similar themes as shared by colleagues, in that we've been unable to pull ourselves away from the additional beds in our system, and some of our ambitions for reform have been slower than we anticipated. So our underlying position is that of a deteriorating position going into 23-24. It doesn't stifle our ambition with regards to we know what good looks like, and we have good support from system partners, as discussed again, the delayed transfers of care, getting people into the right climate is where we're going to make the greatest gains against our deficit. We have a bed base of circa 850 as a core bed base, but we've extended into a bed base just shy of 1,000. We have 185 beds in the system that we need to try and remove post-COVID legacies and so forth. And we too are struggling with COVID outbreaks, and that has been the rate limiting factor in 22-23. So it's been a very difficult year for teams. But I think that as a system, we have a greater understanding of where we can work together to make positive inroads into that deficit. Of course, about 14 million is associated with bed-based care alone, and then the other pressures within the system are from medicines, energy, and our infrastructure. We were talking earlier about the investment required in our infrastructure. So we have some aging estate. I think when I came to the system, caring for Ayrshire was about preparing the system for a new hospital, and it's quite clear that that's not going to happen in the very near future. And so I think that there is a backlog maintenance program and some reform that has slowed up over the last 3 or 4 years, obviously dramatically impacted by the pandemic, that has resulted in a backlog maintenance and some underlying infrastructure weaknesses to be a little bit more exposed as we go into 23-24.
Thank you. And I just really want to give you that opportunity that others have had to set out your challenges. Stephanie Callaghan, can I come to you for a question?
Thank you, convener. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Oh, thank you. Couldn't find my button there. Just to pick up on something that Cathy said around, she spoke about community pathways and teams, and certainly in this committee, we often hear about the importance of early intervention and preventative care. So thinking specifically about like key performance standards, are there things that we should be doing around early intervention and preventative care to ensure that's better reflected as a higher priority? Does that fit into this part at all? Thanks.
So I would say yes, and it gives me an opportunity just to build on what Rafe was saying in response to the previous question. I think our performance framework actually counts the things that we can count. And I think we really have to think about what else do we need to focus on, because that actually then directs attention, and what we pay attention to improves performance. So I think we're certainly, in Chief Execs, have been talking about what else could we actually measure in that prevention, early intervention space, in ways that actually demonstrate value, but also demonstrate where we're doing best practice, and is that something that we could share and replicate to fit local circumstances, because everything isn't just transferable, it's kind of A to B kind of thing. But I think that is something that would be really beneficial to actually focus on, and actually having those measures so that we could actually begin to think about how do we pay attention to those and actually direct change and support change going forward.
And I'll come to Claire.
Yeah, I think it's a really, really important question. I think if we're honest with ourselves, we've had an ambition for the last, well, again, probably as long as I've been in the health service, to invest more in preventative care. And we haven't done that. And I think that leads us to some really challenging policy choices. And I accept these are difficult. But if you look at what we've done over that period, we have continued to invest heavily in acute care because of access issues and not got upstream around preventative. We have continued to invest very significant monies in very high cost medicines, and I accept the argument around that for individual patients. That is obviously a very emotive and very understandable desire to do that, but that means that we are spending more and more money on some of that acute, very specialist care, and we aren't releasing the resource to spend on the preventative care. And so I think there are some very challenging policy choices in there for us as a society about how we choose to use the resources that we've got. And I think we have to get into that conversation with our communities about the type of health and care system we want in the future. And certainly my medical director was here, she would say, going back to that realistic medicine question, is that we have to make sure we have honest conversations with patients about what is realistic in terms of their long-term care, or even short-term care, depending on what their individual circumstances are. So I think there is, as I've said it a couple of times now, I think there are some very significant policy issues that as a society we've got to get into.
Can I bring in Claire Burden?
Thank you. I was going to raise similar issues to Rafe with regards to, we've made some positive inroads with realistic medicine in all care settings. We have good working relationships with primary carers doing their best with that, with the Living Well agenda, through proactive management of chronic disease management patients, and linking well with our community partners. I think it would be fair to say that if we were able to distribute more funds into preventative and living well agendas, so that we tackle the health inequalities agenda for the longer term, it will bear fruit. But as mentioned earlier, the acute pressure does draw resources into that here and now and backlog arena. But our not for the want of enthusiasm through our health and social care partners and council colleagues in wanting to work this agenda with us. Thank you.
Thank you. Can I now move on to talk about COVID recovery and questions from Sandesh Gohani?
Thank you, Convener. Can I start, Ralph, with yourself about the treatment centres? So how does NHS Borders expect to be able to access the treatment centre in Inverness in the Highlands?
We wouldn't expect our patients probably go to Inverness in the Highlands, but we would expect, and we do already, see our patients go to the Golden Jubilee. As other treatment centres come on stream, then I think it's important that we increasingly look at that, that we do look at that resource as a national resource, and and how would we get into the point where we look at the backlog across Scotland and make sure that there's as much equity in access to that as possible. Our, you know, primary focus as a board is to ensure that wherever possible, patients get care locally, but we need to be realistic in our case that a number of patients will always travel outside the borders. They do it for specialist treatment. I think they will increasingly do it around some of the general ones.
So I'm not talking about specialist treatment.
No.
Because we all accept patients have to travel for really specialist treatment. We're talking about ASA 1 and 2 patients who need, for example, a hip operation or a knee operation. You don't expect them to, when the treatment centre is online, to be going to the Highlands. You'd expect them to be going to the Golden Jubilee.
I wouldn't expect them to go to the Highlands, but I would expect them potentially to go to Fife, to Lothian when that comes online, to go to the Golden Jubilee. The bit we will need to get right in the borders is the balance between patients going outside the borders and the patients who we can treat locally, because we've got to sustain a trauma service in the borders and an unscheduled care service, and that requires us to ensure that we've got orthopaedic surgeons, and so they and our surgeons aren't split between elective and urgent. So we need to get the balance right of that, because we need to continue to make sure that those jobs are attractive for our orthopaedic surgeons. So there'll be a balance of what is treated locally, but I am absolutely up for a conversation around what access do we get going forward that addresses the backlog in particular, but then beyond that, what the balance of care is between what we provide locally and what we provide elsewhere.
So you'll need a further conversation to find out about things like extra costs that might be associated with a 23-hour inpatient stay and other the resources you might need to put into a patient going to Golden Jubilee or going to other treatment centres.
Yeah, and we need to look at that against the cost of providing that care locally as well. So,
okay, thank you. I have questions about the recovery plan. From the reading that we've done, it's been suggested that the recovery plan hadn't been discussed with health boards in an extensive way. So when the health recovery plan came out, how close were you to going back to your pre-pandemic levels of outpatient elective work?
I think it's probably fair to say we have been challenged to get back to pre-COVID levels pre-pandemic levels of activity. We have been running over the last 3 or 4 months at about 78%, just under 80% of our outpatient activity, and somewhere between 50 to 60% of our inpatient activity. Some of that is about capacity in the system in relation to beds, particularly in relation to the elective care programme. Some of it is about specific issues to us in one or two specialties that have meant we are challenged. So a very significant part of the deficit in pre-COVID activity in outpatients, for example, is associated with ophthalmology and dermatology, and that is particularly a workforce issue to us rather than a capacity issue. Within orthopaedics, it's more about an elective bed capacity issue and a theatre capacity issue, so different for individual services.
We're mixed. Cathy, can I ask you the same question? What levels are you at compared to your pre-pandemic when it comes to elective work?
So in terms of our total patients waiting at the 1st of March 2023, we've got 4,271 patients. So we are making inroads, and with that we've got 2,372 who are waiting over 12 weeks. But we've tried...
Compared to pre-pandemic levels, where were you with the elective work?
So in terms of our pre-pandemic levels, we probably, in terms of percentage-wise, we're certainly in diagnostics of 86% on track to get back to where we are. As I said earlier to committee members, we have actually invested significantly in scheduled care.
Question was specifically about where were you with elective surgery compared to your pre-pandemic levels?
So in terms of waiting times in specialties like orthopaedics and trauma, we are, I would say, within the next
6 to 9 months, we'll be back on track. And that's very clear in our recovery plan in terms of both outpatients. So the targets that have been set to get us there, 78, 52 weeks and so on, we will meet our 52-week target at the end of March.
So, sorry.
I'm a clear burden. So
I'm just trying to ascertain the answer to the question, which was compared to the pre-pandemic levels.
Yes.
So it's not about the 52...
Yeah, I understand that, we've got half an hour left. Mm-hmm. I've got a multitude of themes to cover. You've had several questions. You come back with the same question a few times. I appreciate you're maybe not satisfied with how Cathy's answered it. But can I bring in Claire Burden to answer your question? And I'm going to go to Paul O'Kane. Claire.
Thank you. At its peak in 2022, we had 8,553 patients on our surgical waiting list. We now have 7,947. We're at 99% of our pre-COVID rates in outpatients, and we're at 78% of pre-COVID in terms of surgery. Our limiting factors have been our critical care unit was no longer fit for purpose in its original area, and our critical care unit is where day case used to be. So we've had some change in baselines. We weren't at these levels at the beginning of 2022. So it's taken a good eight to 12 months to get them back up to these rates. But whilst it's only a modest 600 swing in totals, it's positive that we've started to address a modest reduction in total numbers. And our constant improvement on return to pre-COVID levels. Ambition is to be at 90% of pre-COVID, and that being rate limited by the access to theatres because of the relocation of our critical care unit at Crosshouse. Thank you.
Thank you. Paul Keane.
Thank you very much, convener. I wonder if I can just expand on COVID recovery plans. Audit Scotland, indeed, were critical of the lack of consultation with NHS boards in terms of development of the National Recovery Plan. And also, I think, highlighted that there was a desire from many boards for that greater autonomy in terms of their own recovery plan. So I suppose my question is, do you feel that in your own context it would have been helpful to have that more localised recovery plan that actually you could work to within your resource allocation?
Oh, go on.
So I think, you know, the National Recovery Plan has got a number of headlines. They're not dissimilar to the headlines within Forth Valley. And in terms of the actions that we're taking, whether it's investment in primary care, whether it's investment in urgent and scheduled care, whether it's investment in community care, we do have flexibility about how we do that. And I suppose I did refer to best practice, and it's really good to learn from each other about what we're doing. But sometimes local circumstances disable us to do things exactly the same and get the same return, because we've got a population maybe with different demographics, different epidemiology in terms of presentation. So in terms of our recovery plan in NHS Forth Valley, I don't think it's at odds with the national plan, and there'll be local flexibility within that. The rate limiting factor, as Rafe and I think Claire has mentioned, is the workforce and how ambitious we can be about that. So in Forth Valley, we have invested in the workforce that we've got. So you'll see from my submission that we've invested in creating more Band 3 jobs, so 800 plus people moving from Band 2 to Band 3 because they've got the skill set to do that, and really trying to get everybody up to the top of the licence to meet the backlog, just going back to the previous question. So I'm not uncomfortable about the approach nationally versus locally.
Can I just ask, Cathy, were you specifically asked by government about workforce issues in relation to the National Recovery Plan?
So as a health board, we are asked to submit our workforce plans, which we do, and we've done that. And those workforce plans identify the gaps in specialties or the gaps in workforce and the things that we're doing. And within my own system, locally, we are working with local authorities and so on to think, how do we get people into health and care?
So the workforce plans from health boards are on record, have been shared with the with government colleagues.
Okay.
Can I come to Rafe, and then I'm going to have to move on. We've got a number of themes, including staffing, that we really need to dig into. I'm very conscious we've only got half an hour left with our panel. So, Rafe, if you can answer that, and then I need to move on.
Yeah, it's probably just repeating what Cathy said. I've got no problem with there being a national recovery plan. I think it's helpful to see the overall policy direction that people are wanting us to take. I think individual boards have then adapted that to their local circumstances, which will vary. As Cathy said, we have ongoing engagement with Scottish Government officials on a monthly, if not more frequent, basis, where issues around workforce, etc., are flagged and discussed. So I think that balance between an overall direction at a national level and then understanding what that means for us locally and an ongoing discussion about progress, I think is perfectly appropriate.
Emma, can I bring you in just to pick up on some... I think you had some questions around the progressive recovery plan. I know that we've already mentioned it, but if you can ask your question, then we can move on.
Sure, I will be quick. I had just two questions, but one we can always park for later. It's about the long COVID pathway rather than long COVID clinics that have been established in NHS borders, because I'm interested to know what's the best way to look after long COVID patients. And then the other issue was... Again, it's going back to on Friday, you talked about the progress on recovery has required working with your registered social landlords to look at housing, to look at wider aspects of supporting people in order to practice re-ablement, which we don't use that word a lot, but just basically supporting people to get the best care and to get them home. Is that part of what you're doing for the progress on recovery?
As we said on Friday, I mean, in long COVID, for me, that's about a pathway that signposts people into the right care, because people with long COVID have a variety of needs. So I think it's important that we don't run a long COVID clinic. We try and signpost people into the right service for them as individuals. In terms of reablement, the council social health and social care partnership have been putting quite a focus on reablement, and that for me is about reducing the need over a period of time for social care, and that will release additional social care capacity. So if we can support people as they are discharged from hospital over that initial period, and then adjust their social care packages to meet their ongoing needs, then that is certainly helpful in terms of creating capacity in the system. And certainly the output we've seen from the initial work that they've done is that has been very successful, and I would see that helping address some of the issues we referenced in terms of delayed discharges earlier as we go forward. And that in itself will be then very important in terms of capacity in the hospitals to allow us to address some of the backlog issues.
Thank you. Now some questions from Gillian Mackay on the escalation framework. Gillian.
Thanks, convener. In all the submissions, all boards have obviously been escalated higher levels of the framework, and all boards have a higher than the national average level of turnover. Do you believe that the high level of turnover in your boards is linked to poor culture within the board?
I personally don't, in terms of NHS borders. I think we need to be honest with ourselves that in an organisation the size of the health service, an organisation the size of mine, there will be issues in individual services or issues between individuals at times, and we need to have appropriate mechanisms in place to address that, support people and understand what's behind that and then address that. When I joined NHS Borders 4 years ago now, leadership was one of the issues that we had been escalated on. We were de-escalated for that partway through the pandemic. We've put a lot of work into the way in which we lead the organisation. We've done a lot of work in terms of engaging with our staff and trying to shift our approach. We talk an awful lot now about a compassionate leadership approach. We've just started a compassionate leadership programme for staff across the organisation. We've introduced what we're calling a quality management approach, which is a bit managerial speak, but is focusing on the way in which we engage with our public, engage with our staff. And I think we are making progress with that, but I think it would be incredibly naive of me to sit here and say that we should be complacent about that. I think it's something that we need to continue to work on at all times, because it's really important. I don't particularly think, though, that that relates directly to the turnover issue, which I believe is more directly related in our circumstances to the age profile of our workforce, and particularly the issues that people have experienced over the course of the pandemic. And there is no doubt that that's had an impact on people making different choices.
Can I bring Cathy?
Yeah, absolutely. It's very similar to Rafe. And I think, and I know nobody underestimates the pressure that have been on the workforce during this pandemic. And we continually say a huge thank you to our staff for that. And a number of staff actually during the pandemic and kind of as we've not come out of it, but as we've moved forward, have made those work-life balance choices. A number of people have taken retirement, particularly nursing. A number of people have went into new employment, and a number of people were on fixed-term contracts as a result of the pandemic, whether it was in Test and Protect and so on. So, like Rafe, I don't think turnover is any, in terms of that correlation to culture. However, I think that, like Rafe, we're no complacent. We equally have put in a compassionate leadership programme. We've had Professor Michael West actually supporting us in that. If committee members follow the boards, they will have seen that I brought in an external review to our emergency department way back in 2020, 2021, because of poor culture. So we're no shy of that. And we will absolutely take appropriate action because we want people to come to work and have a good day at work and enjoy their work and actually be supported in their workplace, whether that's with training, development and good leadership. And it's something that we, going forward, have significantly committed to. So thank you.
Can I bring in Claire Burden?
Thank you very much. Very similar themes to my colleagues in that the culture plan is predicated on our commitment to retention, attainment, professional development and recruitment. And I think that there has definitely been some life choices as described by Cathy. So we have many more people reducing the hours that they're offering. Our medical workforce has many contracts now that are much, much smaller than they were 2 or 3 years ago. We have 500 nursing vacancies, and it's just a recruitment cycle that you are just constantly on it. I think it would be fair to share that nationally we have an NHS reputation challenge, in that within the media it's not a great place to work. People are under constant pressure. But from our experience as CEs, I have exceptionally dedicated staff who genuinely love their jobs, and we don't get the opportunity to talk to that. And individually, we work hard on our social medias to try and raise the profile of the dedicated people holding this together for us. But it gets lost in the other national things that are going on. So I think as health boards, we do weight the importance of the training and retention components, because we desperately need, I think particularly us as rural boards, keeping people in our patch and having lifelong careers is absolutely what we're wedded to. But we are very mindful of this backdrop of people not choosing the NHS, being greatly influenced by the media. And I think if we had a concern as a leadership body, this is the first year nursing has gone to clearance. And so the idea that we're not filling all of our university places for our future nurses is something that we need to tackle for Scotland, because we need people genuinely choosing healthcare as a profession, because it is lifelong rewarding. And so if there were a piece of work that we are really keen to work on, it's that national bit. We understand that we are in recovery and there are pockets of exceptional stress that we work through every day, but there is a lot going into the supporting of our workforce. And I think that the age profile is a big thing for all of us. The national position of primary care, and that we know that in the next decade, the turnover in that is extraordinary. So the retention and that recruitment arena is equally as important as that internal culture and our visible leadership commitments.
Thanks, Convener. And yeah, I will be the first one every time to stand up and say that they're good careers to go into and that this is not the reality in every single department and every single hospital. However, I think it's really important that when we are being told about these conditions by staff, that we make sure that we are addressing them so that these workplaces are supportive for absolutely everyone. And if I could, from a supplementary, go back to Cathy in particular about Forth Valley, which obviously was escalated on culture pre-escalation. I've spoken to a number of staff members who all told me that senior management are remote from the workforce and were rarely seen. We obviously had five respiratory consultants resigning, all citing a toxic culture. Since the escalation, I've had psychological therapy staff in touch saying that because of the 2-year waits, they're so worried about patients that they're working unpaid hours. What's being done to both acknowledge the culture that staff have been working under, and how is this going to be sorted going forward? Because it seems to be that's at least 3 or 4 departments within Forth Valley alone.
So thank you for that. I think in terms of an escalation, we would acknowledge that there are issues and that we are tackling those issues. In relation to psychological therapies, we've actually been able to recruit additional staff into that area because that was an area where we had below the national average, and I think when you're below the national average and you're actually trying to perform, then actually there is impact. I'm actually very close to staff. I have high visibility. I think the areas that you reference are on the acute hospital site, mm-hmm. particularly. And if people follow the acute hospital site, you will see that we had a number of staff for a variety of reasons working not in their substantive posts but actually acting into posts. We've took a decision to actually bring in an acting manager whilst we look to recruit to other posts to fill that space, and that has enabled people to go back to their substantive posts. So people like our chief nurse on the acute site and actually bringing in an additional doctor for our front door and so on. So putting people back into their substantive posts. I think if you were to ask staff just now, and I do regularly ask staff, they would say that it feels better. And the litmus test for me is also not just the staff, but our staff side, our trade unions, where we have very close working relationships with. And they say that the stability in the acute site feels so much better with that additional management capacity and that leadership.
For context, Cathy, that psychological therapy staff member was in touch in the last 24 hours about staff working unpaid hours because they're so concerned about patients. So I'm slightly concerned about what we do until those new staff that have been recruited are in post, because obviously there's often a lag between recruitment happening. And I think it was about 12 weeks, I think it said in your submission about that as well.
So in terms of, we've actually had a change with our union colleagues because NHS Forth Valley was an outlier in actually allowing people to have a month's notice and recruit to that. The trade unions were really keen to support a 3-month. So that actually gave us a huge gap in terms of caseload redistribution whilst we fill vacancies. That has been resolved. Our staff side have worked with us to resolve that. So we're now in the same place that other NHS boards are in. So that will certainly help mm-hmm. us. In terms of the member of staff speaking to you, I will absolutely, you know, follow that up. We would not expect anyone to work mm-hmm. unpaid hours to be addressing waiting times. You'll have seen in our submission that we've worked really, really hard to address long waits. Mm-hmm. We've continually sat in that 70% performance, and that was in the backdrop of not having those staff in post. Mm-hmm. But I will certainly follow that up.
That's great.
Thank you. If you want to come in, you don't. That's great, because we do not have an awful lot of time. We need to talk about staffing more generally. Can I go to Paul O'Kane?
Thank you very much, Convener. Looking at the information submitted, you know, there is a huge issue, I think, in terms of retention of staff, not just recruitment of new staff. I mean, 30% of leavers are retiring in the NHS Ayrshire and Arran, and we see that turnover in your boards obviously higher than the national average. I suppose just that question then about retention in the system, I mean, is that the significant issue, I think, first of all? And secondly, what action has been taken to try and encourage staff to stay within the system so that we don't have that twin challenge of having to recruit new staff and indeed try to keep staff in the system? And I wonder if we might go to the perspective of Ayrshire and Arran first, if that's possible.
Claire Burden.
Thank you.
Program there, it's multifaceted, as you can imagine. The training of staff and getting people into a position where they can see the way out from the current operating processes is genuinely the thing that's going to make the difference. So over the last 3 years, the single disease management has stifled careers. So COVID by its nature has meant that people haven't specialised and had the opportunities to specialise. And in the current climate, releasing people to specialise is a challenge. So within our recruitment and retainment commitment is the release to people to training. Sorry, would you like something else covered, Paul? Sorry,
whatever I can, just briefly then. I mean, you're saying people haven't had the chance to specialise, but would you recognise actually stress and burnout is actually the major issue?
There is a lot of anxiety. So if you're looking at staff absence, anxiety and stress is absolutely a key driver in that the current climate is tough. And looking after people when you are working with a five-year, the equivalent to a five-year backlog, and the system still remaining under pressure, it is without a doubt that well-being program about how we keep people fit for work is equally as important as finding careers that they can see themselves beyond the current position. So the commitment to get people training in order that they can see a future that is different from what they've got now is a really important part of the retention programme, in that if you and I were to walk around the any part of the health system, their request is they need more staff, and the second request is they need more time together, and they need opportunities to train. Our healthcare professionals have had a stall of their professional development for 3 years, and that will have ramifications for a long time. But as we do get into a position of recovery, we get back to a rate by which we genuinely start chipping away at the pressures for the elective programme, we will be able to support more training for our staff. And we're doing a lot of work with NES about the development of new roles, about how we can find new career pathways for people, because those people who are retiring early are making choices to take a break. There's always a retention and callback, but there is an appetite to come back and do slightly different things. So if you've been working within the acute, actually to do something different within the community with a different skill set is welcomed by our staff. So we will continue to work with NES on how we generate new posts by which we can give people new avenues to pursue caregiving and intervention. And we talked earlier about the prevention arena. Those people that are leaving the NHS by choice, taking retirement at 55 and beyond, and those pension options that we're all living with. It's our belief that if we can create posts that are genuinely different, we will have people return.
Can I come to Rafe and then Cathy? I'm afraid that I'm not going to be able to go back to Paul for supplementary questions. I do apologise, but we have got another panel to come in, so I can't let this overrun. So if I can come to Rafe and then Cathy.
Yeah, probably complements what Claire says. I mean, I think it's important that we don't jump to some single issues assumptions. I think the choice for any member of staff to leave, move on, retire, whatever that is, will be multifactorial. I think from my point of view, some of it is about the working age of our population in the rural areas and people making choices around that. Some of it is about their experience over the pandemic. We moved numbers of staff because we had to do that, and that was more or less popular depending on the individual. There are issues around, there is no doubt, and it goes a little bit back to the culture bit, which is, I think, that the thing I hear most from staff is their frustration at the moment that they are not being able to do the job that they came in to do because they don't feel they're delivering the quality of care that they would have previously delivered, and that's about the pressure in the system, and I think that's a big driver. So we have to recognise it's multifactorial. We need to support people through that with professional development, as Claire's outlined. We focus on retire and return, so that we try and support people back into different roles maybe after they have retired part-time and build on their skills. And then there's the fundamental bit about if we get the recruitment right, then that will support retention because it will take some of the pressure off staff. And we've done masses of work over the last year in terms of international recruitment and have been, I think, very successful in bringing international recruits into the organisation. That is challenging, but I think it is paying dividends. And if we can do that and that reduces some of the pressure on our staff, then that will improve retention. And that, to some extent, goes back to the point I made much earlier about one of the reasons our staff, particularly in the acute hospital, but there'll be different circumstances in different parts of the system. But one of the reasons we've got pressure is we've got additional beds open and we've had to therefore spread staff more thinly, and that puts pressure on them. So if we can get to the point where we close down those extra beds that we've had available during the pandemic, that will allow us to improve staffing levels and that will help improve retention. But I think we have to recognise we need to work really, really hard at it. And in the medium term, we need to recognise that that working age population is shrinking, and therefore we're going to have to look differently at the way we staff our services.
Okay. Cathy, come to you and then we'll come to Chess White.
Just very quickly, so as Rafe and Claire were saying, the pressures within the system are significant, and we have been really fortunate. Just to give you an idea of some of the recruitment retention, so out of the new nurses that we've recruited just over the last couple of years, 127 new starts are in our system, and we've still got 118 within our system. So that's a good measure for us. And in terms of our iMatter scores, in terms of going back to that culture, we're actually up there amongst the rest of the boards in Scotland. I think the other things is trying to give staff space to do things. So our mental health staff have been awarded the Royal College accreditation, very unique accreditation, because we gave them time to do that, and it lets them shine and feel really proud about what they're doing and how they're doing it. We've invested, as I said previously, in bands of 2 to 3, and I think that is demonstrating a culture of inclusiveness, a culture of commitment to development, and those staff are staying with us. Similar to what Rafe was saying, we have been able to secure colleagues from other countries, so our international recruitment, very focused not just on the employment, but the welfare and the bringing of people to Scotland and their families, and that has been hugely successful. We've also done a bit of work around our anchor institution concept, about how we actually create local jobs for local people, really thinking about how we do that with local authorities. And we have very recently secured a unique partnership with both our college and university, where we're actually working in that space to actually bring school leavers into health and care, both the health service and social care. But it's a tough gig out there, and I would never underestimate that. And I think, going back to Gillian's question, the acute site in particular in Forth Valley is a tough place to work, as is primary care, given the demand coming through our systems. And that's about respecting our staff and acknowledging that's what they're working in. That's what they want to hear from us as leaders, so that they get reassurance
that we absolutely know the pressures they're working under, and give them the support. And training and development is one of those areas, and giving commitment to protected time so that people do have a bit of downtime, a bit about reconnecting, reskilling and so on. So I think certainly our focus is very much on, one, recruiting, but two, retaining and doing different things with our staff so that their skill sets are increasing.
Thank you. Thank you. Tess.
Two questions. My first one is to NHS Borders. So, Mr. Roberts, in advance of today, we asked for a 4-page document. You provided a document with no less than 8 embedded papers and didn't provide us with what we asked for. So please, so that we do, as a committee, have a written response from you, similar to the other trusts, could you please provide us with what we asked for? Thank you.
I'm sorry if that didn't meet the what you were expecting. Certainly happy to review that. We tried to give you as much information as possible, but we'll reflect on that.
Thank you. If you could just deliver exactly what we asked for, that would be appreciated. And then my second question is for Forth Valley, please. So sickness does continue to be an issue right across the trusts. In terms of what percentage is actual physical sickness for nurses and midwives, and what percentage is mental illness, so burnout, depression?
So we do have a breakdown. I don't have it in front of me. As Claire said, stress will be high, and that absence rate, there is no doubt about that. To actually say that's all about work, because we actually do significant deep dives in that, there will be areas of that. But the cost of living and other things, other factors in people's lives are playing a part in that.
Sorry, that doesn't answer the question. Sorry. It's what percentage, please, is physical illness for the nurses and midwives, and what percentage is mental illness?
So I don't have that figure in front of me. We actually have a figure, and within that figure we have a breakdown of cause.
OK, so if you could provide that would be appreciated. That, thank you. Yes. Thank you, convener.
David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel members. We talk about stress and burnout, but what are you putting in place for the well-being of your staff? Not about progression in careers, that. What is actually in place for the well-being of your staff so they continue to
Can I go around it, all three, yes. That? If I maybe take Claire first.
We have extensive well-being programmes. We have a very positive spiritual team who lead our wellbeing programme. It's there's dedicated space and time with a wide range of resources in terms of access to financial advice, occupational health therapy. We, for the first time as a result of the pandemic, the legacy is psychiatric and psychological support. It's rather sad that you feel that you need to have that in the level that we have, but between the spiritual team and our professional support services, they have a steady flow of people. The response from staff has been very positive to the wellbeing areas that have been created with timeout sessions. Within the team management structure, going back to our cultural commitments, making time for teams to make use of those facilities is core parts of our commitment to professional development. So I think now that we're in an era where distancing and so forth has diminished over the last 12 months, we have been in a better position to offer breakout support, and we've invested independently as teams have needed them. So sadly, bad events happen in the NHS by nature of the beast, and we have commissioned specific support programmes for following specific incidents or for teams that have undergone a serious incident. And then we've got wider stream, more generic processes and services available through our cultural plan and our human resource teams, where teams can commission timeout. So it's it's wide ranging from that high specialist where somebody needs support into wellbeing spaces that they can access 24/7 into team development programmes.
Thank you. Can I ask my next panelist to be brief, please? Rafe and then Cathy.
Yeah, I mean, a range of support. There's very targeted support for individual teams around individual incidents or issues when they happen. More generally, we've got staff counselling services. We've got the Occupational Health and Safety Service. We've got psychological support for staff. We've got a wellbeing group that's looked at issues around things like meals and the space that staff have got to go to. We explicitly ran a workforce conference in the autumn to try and focus on our workforce issues, which was attended by probably close to 100 staff and was really successful. And we're working up to a wellbeing week in June this year, again, to try and maintain a focus on it. I think fundamentally, that go back to that point, I've heard that the things staff want most of all, in addition to sort of individual targeted support where that's necessary, is that sense of they are doing the job that they came in to do. And that is about us supporting them, supporting staffing levels. And as Claire, I think, said earlier, trying to get back to that point where the health service is seen as a good career and is seen in that context, and staff frankly have found it very difficult to go from that transition of being clapped on the doorsteps at the beginning of the pandemic to the point where they now feel they are under endless pressure from the public, from politicians and others, and that has been a really difficult shift in mindset for them, and I think we all have to recognise that and support
media,
them
media
that.
Headlines as well. I mean, I imagine that the going back to what you were saying before about the national conversation that we need to have, the things that make the headlines are not the sort of nuanced things about things going well. They're always about the waiting times. And
I think they are, our staff say to me a lot that they are looking for the acknowledgement that we need to radically change the health service going forward, and we need to change the dynamic and the conversation we're having around that, and recognise that the health service needs to continue to evolve. That's what they're looking, probably more than anything, is a recognition that we can't just go on flogging the service as it currently is, and we need to change it.
Thank you. Cathy, and then I must move on.
Yeah, very quickly, really kind of ditto what Rafe and Claire says. We are thinking about the health service at a local level, about what needs to change, and actually mobilising our clinical teams to be part of that is really important. We've produced a wellbeing plan strategy, which actually outlines all the things that we've been doing, all the things that we continue to commit to do, and they're targeted, or they're generic in terms of people being able to access. But there is a plan that if people, I can actually provide that, or people can access it to see the extent, and it is significant in terms of the investment that we've put in there.
Must move on. I do want to take, we've got two other themes, one on mental health services and other than reform. However, I might not be able to take all the members that have asked to ask questions on them, and I do apologise. Evelyn Tweed on mental health services. I'm afraid just one question.
I'll roll my questions up together then.
Thank you.
thanks, convener. I'm going to direct my question to Cathy. Obviously, Cathy covers the Stirling area. I have had various constituents in contact with me regarding the CAM service at the end of their tether. I do know that things are getting better and your numbers are getting better, but what have you done to enhance the service? How quickly can we see more progress? And crucially, what is being done to help people in the period where they can't be seen, that sort of 18 weeks waiting time when they are in a crisis mental health situation?
So a couple of things. If I start with primary care, so we have invested in, or even before that, so working with council colleagues on the investment, government investment in counselling, so that actually we're taking that prevention early intervention approach, so that we're not seeing escalation into the tier services within CAMHS. So really starting
right where kids are engaging. In primary care, we've invested in CAMHS staff, CAMHS workers, so that the GP has got access to that service. And most importantly, we have laid out the kind of referral proposal about referring people into primary care and then subsequently into services. You're right to point out that we have made progress. Our focus coming out of the pandemic was to deal with our long waits. You'll see that those were significant. I'm pleased to say that we have actually addressed those long waits, and I think staff are feeling really good about that, because that does impact on staff when they've got children and families that they feel they're not supporting. So those long waits, tackling those long waits enables us now to actually deal with the front of the waiting list. So you'll actually see very quickly us moving from a really poor position in terms of that 18 weeks to achieving the standard by the first quarter of this year in April to June.
Thank you. Evelyn, I can't bring you back in. I've got two more members want to ask a question, very succinct question, hopefully on reform. Can I come to Stephanie Callaghan first and then to Sandesh Gohani? And if you can direct your question as much as possible, please.
Thank you very much, Convener. I actually thought someone was going to add this to their question, so I apologise. I'm just wondering specifically about any recommendations that you would like to see this committee making around early intervention to ensure that that's a priority going forward. Thanks.
Okay, let's go around everyone quickly. Rafe.
We'd probably go back to the point I made before around prioritising that, and I think that means we need to look at our performance framework and look at the way in which we prioritise that. There is certainly work we can do to focus on early intervention, but I think that requires us to look at the whole scope of our resource and make judgments about how and where we prioritise that across the organisation. Thank you.
Thank you, Cathy.
Very similar. I said earlier about performance framework and actually having the incentive to actually have standards to actually work towards. I think that would actually help us to refocus our energies into that area of significance.
Okay. I'll come to Claire.
Thank you. As an open question, the ask, the our diagnostic work and our technical infrastructures, the unifying of our ICT will genuinely help us with the reconnaissance of our population. And as we're working to national models to improve access to diagnostics, getting into that prevention agenda, so adding and building on both Rafe's and Cathy's platforms, that would be my ask, diagnostics and technology. Thank you.
Thank you, very helpful. And Sandesh, one last question to you.
Thank you, Convener. I just want to say that as a doctor, it is a great career to be in health. And I think I want to be clear to acknowledge that myself and everyone on our health committee acknowledge and thank our NHS staff for all their hard work. As far as questions go, Convener, I think that, you know, I was disappointed with some of the answers I got. I'm sure we have other questions, so perhaps we could write.
We're gonna write and pick up on things that we haven't had time to, get to.
If I could directly ask Claire about your IT infrastructure, I was very interested to hear about how you're trying to develop this all-in IT infrastructure, and very quickly, as we are running over time, mm-hmm. How close are you to implementing?
Work going on for the platform, the network. So we have quite a lot of remedial work to do before our colleagues start to see it. So the technical infrastructure, the platform from which we can unify our system, is the piece of work that we're doing first. And the two pieces of software are the track care for the hospital, so that we take out three pieces of kit to unify to one, and our commitment to the electronic patient record, which is One for Scotland compliant. And we have our health and social care partners' support that they will make sure that we're all able to share that.
Thank you very much. I want to thank all three of you for your time this morning. And as I said, we will write to you with some of the things that we haven't managed to get to. As you can see, a great deal of things that we wanted to ask you, great things, the things you wanted to tell us. But we will pause and suspend for 10 minutes for a break. Thank you.
We now move on to the second evidence session as part of our inquiry into female participation in sport and physical activity. This session will focus on community sport and physical activity. I welcome to the committee Kate Juster, the Policy and Influencing Coordinator for Scotland for Living Street Scotland, Patrick Murphy, the Senior Manager for South Lanarkshire Leisure and Culture, and we've got Cecilia Orlam, the Head of Behavioural Change for SusTrans Scotland. And we've got two panel members that are online. We've got Kirsty Garrett from Sports Development and Physical Activity Manager for Glasgow Life and Glasgow Sport, and Ewan Lowe, the Chief Executive Officer of Scottish Swimming. So, members, just we've got a number of themes to cover. I think you might want to sort of direct your questions. I mean, some of them might be more general, and we'll go around the panel. With five panel members, not every panel member is going to be able to answer every question, or else we'll be here till next week. I'd like to kick things off because I think a number of you in your submissions pointed to lack of female role models in sport and physical activity, and it struck me that there's lots of females in sport and various physical activity that probably within that sport are a role model, but it's not so much that, it's the cutting through to people out with that sport, seeing them in the media, etc., as role models. And also a lack of women in leadership roles within sport as well. So I'd like to go around everyone. I've just completely be hypocritical in what I've said about focusing things. But can I go around everyone and just ask you what you think could be done to both encourage more women into leadership roles within sport and how to, I suppose, promote those female role models that would make all the difference? Kate, can I come to you?
It's a bit funny one talking about role models when we're talking about sort of everyday walking. So we know that there's quite a lot of importance of role modelling within the family and around family habit forming. So it's important that walking as a means of transport and as a pleasant thing to do is something that happens within families. It's less to do with sort of celebrity role models. There's sort of less of a less evidence that that's a factor there. But what we do need is women in leadership in terms of creating the structures within which women walk. So when we're talking about planning and transport planning and that sort of thing, those are important places to see more women, because we see our transport and our places planned, broadly speaking, by male-dominated professions. And sometimes that's very obvious. Sometimes you can see that transport is planned around a very typical male commute, which goes from home to work and back again, and not around more typically female trip chaining. So you might drop the kids at school before you go to work, do the shopping on the way back, or drop in on a relative that you care for on the way back. Transport doesn't support that. But also the ways that, for example, we see paths being planned, women have a closer attention on safety, and we quite often see that's not supported by the places that we're walking through.
Yeah, they certainly chime with me as a rural person. That radial journey is just into the centre of town, and it doesn't take into account that you might have to go elsewhere before you even get to your work. Patrick, from your perspective.
Yeah, I think the report does reflect that, but I do think there's lots of really, really good work out there just now in and around, especially for young leaders in and around programmes like Active Schools and programmes in local authorities, especially in and around the care experience scenario. So I do think there is some really, really good work there where females will see that bleeding into the narrative about them then coming in and being role models and leaders in the local communities. And that's everything from sports leadership sessions at primary schools right through to walk leaders, right through to, you know, leaders in sport in positions that actually make an influence. So I'm quite positive about that.
Cecilia.
Yeah, I'd like to echo what Kate said about transport planning and urban planning needing more female leaders and more female perspectives. I also wanted to mention a campaign that SusTrans has run called Anti-Cycles, which was based on workshops with teenage girls across the country, looking at the barriers to being more active physically in their local environments. And that's kind of progressed into a social media campaign where the young women are leading on content about them being physically active, and it's kind of proving that locally based initiatives that empower young women to be physically active can really have quite a good impact, and it showcases what's possible.
And as you were speaking, I'm reminded that I asked a teenage person in my life why girls don't do as much physical activity, and she said, because your pals don't, you know, and that sort of peer pressure. So something like that, what you're talking about, where it's like it's seen to be okay to be taking your bike to school or whatever, then more girls might actually do it. Can I come online and speak to Kirsty first of all?
Hi there. Thanks for inviting me along. With regards to role models, we have an example where, unfortunately, just prior to lockdown, COVID, in late 2019, we established a programme called Energise Her, and the brand was I She Can. So the Energise programme was about insight, training and support to engage and attract a wide range of females to a variety of activities within their community. Within that Energise programme, we also had Ment Her. Again, mentors, female mentors, that would share their skills and knowledge to empower others and hopefully excite young women and girls to get involved in sport. And also as part of the programme, we had Activate Hers. Again, it was people that came forward that we trained and supported from different sports clubs and organisations, and help them, support them, deliver projects and activities within their community. And there was a small fund attached to that, to the value of about £1,000. So we definitely saw the need for role models in communities, and therefore that's where we went out to our network of clubs and organisations to take this project forward. A real mix of women came forward. It was co-produced, and it was women from a, what you might say, a performance centre sport, right down to people who weren't involved in sport when they were at school or PE. So it was a genuine mix. It carried on into 2020, but unfortunately COVID came, so we're now just trying to go back to reinvigorate that programme. So we do have that programme in place. Another part of role models we're celebrating this year is Glasgow's European Capital of Sport 2023. So for the month of February, we celebrated Women and Girls in Sport Month. So basically over the month, we just celebrated all the activities that were happening in the city from sports clubs and organisations, just so they can raise awareness within their communities of all the things that are going on. And we put out regular tweets and newsletters, etc. And hopefully the understanding would be that there would be more young people would know what's happening in their community, young women, and therefore take part. So role models for us, yes, we're really keen. What we're also looking at as part of European Capital Sport is hopefully I can meet your heroes, so young women and women can identify people that they aspire to or look up to and hopefully meet them. So for example, we had a young woman meet her hero, Scottish player Jen Beattie. So therefore we're trying to, as I say, develop opportunities throughout the year for women and girls to get involved in activity. With regards to leadership roles, I am a sports development physical activity manager. I'm a female, and I'm pleased to say I have roughly about 100 members of staff. And there is a split, quite a nice split between 50-50 of male and female. So within our own organisation, I'm comfortable about, as I say, that we have a split of male and female that are strong roles that are in communities and helping people get involved in sport and physical activity. So, yes.
Thank you, Kirsty. Thank you, Kirsty. We'll come to Ewan.
Yeah, thank you, convener, and good morning, everybody. And yeah, thanks for inviting me along. I'm just picking up on that very last point that Kirsty was making there. I am conscious that I am a male speaking in this subject matter. We're very conscious of that even coming into this committee meeting today. There would have been another member of the team you would naturally like to bring along to this, but it's committed elsewhere. So you're having to put up with me today. So, but what I would say in that kind of leadership piece is, I'm sitting as part of a senior management team, of which there are three out of the five of that senior management team are female. We have three members of the board out of 10 who are female. We're just about to have a president who's going to be female for the organisation in Scottish Swimming, which is a fairly prominent role to have. In terms of, I suppose, from a swimming perspective, from that, you need to be able to see it and understand it and believe it to be able to want to participate in it. We probably are quite fortunate in that swimming is a popular activity, and from a recreational point of view, there are probably more females than males participate in this particular activity. And from a membership point of view, we sit somewhere in the region of about 63-64% female to male, or 64% of our membership is made up of females. And inside of that, if you look around to the leadership roles of people who have influence, if you like, inside that membership base, from a workforce point of view, 63% are female. From an officials point of view, 62% are female. And from a coaching point of view, again, 62% are females. So, there's a female drive across the sport. But in other aspects, picking up a little bit of comments that have already been made, of I do very mindful of first impressions and getting people involved in the sport and even interested in activity and leisure and wider sports full stop. Comes from quality experiences, and active schools, as mentioned earlier on, is quite a prominent activity to be able to get people to introduce to leadership roles. And for ourselves, we've taken it a step further with a young volunteer program, which particularly try and not just gender, but also ability and also ethnic minorities. We try to get involved in this young leadership program. We have developed our Leaders of the Future, and there are quite a high percentage of females involved in that programme, and it's driven by a female. So other aspects, I suppose, from that see it and do it piece, we are mindful of some of the names that people might be familiar with, of Hannah Miley, very prominent, successful swimmer, Scottish swimmer, who's actually got an MBE for promoting services for girls and women's sport. Very active in that kind of world of promoting all the values of being interested in activity. And others coming through, Katie Shanahan, Mr. Kirsty will know Katie's name. They are role models, along with Tony Shaw from Aberdeen, who is a para-athlete and is an ambassador for us in our Learn to Swim programme to encourage youngsters to get involved. So not just a female aspect, but also a disability aspect of anybody can get involved in this activity. So we're working where we can, but very conscious there is more to do, given the challenges of I suppose getting any part of the society involved in participation is an ongoing challenge, but particularly girls and women.
Thank you. Paul Sweeney, you have a couple of questions on this.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. I recently met with Boxing Scotland, who are based in Glasgow, and they told me about their work in trying to get women and girls into sport, particularly ones that are traditionally male dominated, such as boxing and football. And there was a feeling that if you don't get young people into sport early in life, it's harder to strike up that engagement once they're young adults. So do the panel have a view on what steps can be taken to encourage women and girls in sport at a young age, especially in ways that encourages them to participate and stay involved in physical activity in the longer term, and how you make that introduction to sports that are traditionally male dominated, like boxing?
Up as a Glasgow rep, or
a bit people on that, because it was about sport rather than just physical activity. Yeah. Can I bring in Kirsty?
Yeah, thanks for that question. With regards to sport, we actively work with any sports governing body, clubs that want to work with Glasgow Life. So, for example, we would work with Boxing Scotland and introduce them to maybe our colleagues in active schools in Glasgow City Council, and try and, as I say, arrange activities that can happen within the school environment, or more so create those links from the school to the club. So we have examples of that goes on in the city. So, yeah, we would openly work with any governing body that wishes to work with us and make sure we can support them get into the school environment, or supporting the young people in the school to move into see a club environment. That's basically what the club development team do, is trying to ensure those connections. So what we would do, Paul, is just ask for the person to contact myself, and then we would take that forward. We also have in Glasgow Sport a physical activity finder, so we promote that as well. So we encourage all sports clubs and organisations in the city to sign up to that physical activity finder. So if you put in your postcode, all the clubs within your area would then become visible, or vice versa. If you put in that you want to do boxing, again, if you put that activity in, then all the boxing opportunities in the city would pop up as well. So again, we try to make sure that people are aware of this activity finder, so therefore they can find activity on their doorstep or a certain sport. But with regards to the boxing, yeah, we would actively encourage them to support active school programmes, etc., to try and encourage young women to get involved.
Sure.
Kirsty's right. I think there's another element in there in terms of females and that specific sport that you've mentioned, Paul, and around the teenage drop-off, you know, at that kind of 13, 14 age bracket, especially in around specific sports, which is very difficult to combat. Again, that leadership role plays into that. But I think what's critical here as well is recognising where sports are in their state of readiness or where clubs are in their state of readiness as they approach their communities. And quite often they can be quite intimidating places. They can be places that aren't ideal for people who are vulnerable or people who are not confident. So I think it's as much on the sports and the clubs themselves in terms of their state of readiness as well as that convergent access about the teenage drop-off.
That is really helpful insights, and I think that's that balance about passive advertising of availability versus actually engaging groups that might, particularly young women who might not feel comfortable and intimidated by a sport like boxing, to taste it and have a go at it. And maybe that opportunity through the active schools provision is something that could be looked at as an opportunity. That certainly sounds interesting, and certainly we've heard stories before about young people in PE classes, for example, being split into groups to have kind of fairly stereotypical different sports. So girls would go off and do dancing and the boys would go off and do football, and these kind of stereotypical sort of streaming of different sports can be extremely counterproductive. Is that something you've observed happening, and how do you think this, for example, this activity schools program could help address some of that, where it's kind of non-traditional engagement?
I'll go to Patrick and I'll come to Kirsty.
Yeah, I think that at the moment, and to take the football example, Paul, the Scottish women's game's never been in a better place. I think there's five of the top Premiership teams now have full-time position. They're all full-time, all the players. So that's a real positive, and so that there's going to be some seriously really good role models coming out of that.
Yeah.
I think PE has a place of work to do in and around that co-production collab about where people's positive destinations are. I think that's a real challenge. And there's also some really positive things happening in and around that transition between girls playing, boys playing netball and girls playing football. That is happening. So I think we're in a good place with that.
That's good to hear.
Kirsty?
Yeah, I'd just like to give an example. We have a boxing club on the south side, so South Side Boxing Academy, for example, Paul. And through our support and through funding, through our club and officials award, Antonia was able to secure, you know, a Boxing Scotland Level 1 course qualification, and therefore start to deliver boxing within the South Side Boxing Academy. So it's things like that that we also support. So a female want to become a coach or etc. So there's opportunities, I'd say, through our funding also to ensure that more female coaches are visible within our communities.
That's great. Thanks.
Thank you. I'd like to move on to talking about issues that have come up in many of our submissions about safety and harassment, putting women and girls off physical activity and sport, and questions led by Tess White.
Thank you very much, Convener. I've got three questions. So my first question to Patrick Murphy, please. So Patrick, how could sports environments and changing facilities be improved to ensure that women and girls feel safe?
Well, I think firstly, it's really important to know about, you know, at the moment, one of my main roles and my job is in and around the efficiencies and our estate shrinking to be able to deliver all the sports and physical activities we do across swimming pools, golf courses and everything else. And then there's a second challenge in there about what you've just noted there about the physical environments. So, really, really difficult at the moment, especially with an ageing estate. You know, you have an ageing estate that is, in some situations, not fit for purpose, and not fit for purpose for certain groups and certain diverse elements of the community. So I think that's a real challenge in and around funding and finance at the moment for us.
OK, so that's a huge issue. And
massive.
Thank you. And a direct question to Ewan Lowe, please. So, Ewan, at the weekend, a swimming coach said to me that there is a huge issue right now in swimming in that mixed changing rooms, that girls don't feel safe, and particularly with mobile phones. And he said that girls are being put off swimming now, and also including at elite level, because pictures are being taken of them in swimming mixed changing rooms. What are you going to do to keep women and girls safe in swimming?
Interesting. I'd be quite happy to follow that one outside the committee, so we'll find a bit more detail around that one, Tess. But I suppose it's important to keep in mind that we do have safety and well-being of all participants at the heart of everything we do, particularly in light of a five pointed to the White Review and to gymnastics across the UK. And a lot of that, I suppose, is encouraging people to come forward and discuss any issues or concerns they may have. And to help facilitate with that at a local club level, we do operate with each club must have a wellbeing protection officer in place to help promote at least one wellbeing protection officer in place to help promote safe environments. And that includes the particular point, I suppose, you're suggesting in there, and there is the use of mobile phones, which is a challenging area. And I mean, from a societal point of view, it's a challenging area when you do have apps in place now which encourage youngsters take snaps and photographs at any given opportunity. That is a challenge for any sporting context, never mind just swimming, to be able to deal with. But to mitigate that sort of use of mobile phones, we do have a mobile phone use policy, which we encourage or don't encourage. We ask clubs to adopt, and many of them do, and they reinforce that through their committees and with their members about appropriate use of mobile phones at a swimming venue, particularly inside of a changing space. So we are doing what we can and be able to promote the need to make sure that mobile phones are used in the right way where at all possible. On the changing aspect and changing village side of view, there is, just as Patrick's outlined, I mean, undoubtedly one of the challenges that sport and leisure is facing at any kind of level is the upkeep, maintenance and ability to run a good quality service with the funding situation and funding problems we do have with the rise and increase in energy costs, and with it the workforce issues that we do have that many of our partners we're aware of are contending with at the moment. That makes it a challenging situation for any council or trust to provide good quality experience as maybe they would perhaps like to, given the financial burdens in place, and that would include the environments, including changing environments. What I would say around the changing environments is there most definitely is not something that we, through Sport Scotland, typically support sports or local authorities and leisure trusts with guidance to refer to around design and build of changing spaces. And typically the more modern approach that has been for a good number of years is to have like changing villages to open to all. And that's with the right intent of making them as inclusive as possible. Inside of there, I am aware that in some circumstances, depending on authorities, there are options to be able to secure or lock down particular sections of those changing villages for a particular user groups if that's required and needed. But that's very much up to local operators to be able to manage those situations. So I do think there are mitigations in place there, Tess, and a lot of these things are probably locally down to local decision maker. I don't mean that in a negative sense. I mean, there are need to understand the communities and how best to work with inside of the mitigations we do have in place to provide the right experience. So not pleasing to hear your earlier comments, and happy to pick that one up at a later date.
Well, neither answer from Patrick and Ewan fill me with trust and confidence. So it's a very simple question with a very long answer, not really getting to the nub of the problem. So my next question, convener, if I may, is what measures could be introduced, and this is for Cecilia, please. Cecilia, what measures could be introduced to improve reporting and investigation of harassment, bullying and abuse in community sport? Thank you.
Well, so in community sport, we work on physical activity in communities. In terms of reporting and investigation, that's something that we would like to see reduced. I'm not sure I can speak for
Just to improve reporting, just any thoughts on how to improve reporting of harassment and bullying in community sport? Any thoughts? We can follow up separately afterwards if that's okay.
And coming from Sustrans, maybe doesn't have much to say in this area.
We don't work with community sport. Such, we kind of promote physical activity, everyday walking and cycling.
I was just wondering if you personally had any views.
So can I maybe come to somebody who's actually more involved in sport? Kirsty, you might have some thoughts on this.
Ewan as well. When it comes to working with clubs and organisations, we try to make sure they are inclusive as possible and safe as possible. It's sometimes very difficult to do that, but we do have in place training and education, be it through the governing body or local authorities or like ourselves, Glasgow Life. We will do courses like in safe hands and child protection, etc., and safeguarding vulnerable adults. So ideally what you'd also then expect is the club to have good governance, good finance structures, but also then a good code of conduct within their club. So therefore, if an incident was to happen, then the young person or the person would know exactly who to speak to, and therefore they would take it down an appropriate route, which may involve a governing body to be involved, or may involve ourselves, Glasgow Life, depending on what the actual circumstance of incident's been. But we would expect our sports clubs and organisations to have a code of conduct and best practice and fair play, etc., all within their structures, so as to make sure that these can be dealt with at a local level, and if not a local level, then escalate to a governing body or ourselves.
Thank you, Convene.
Thank you. I would like to ask Kate and Cecilia, from the perspective of quite a lot of women and girls, even if they're not involved in structured physical activity, might cut out maybe the few bits of physical activity that they get by opting not to walk places, opting not for safety and harassment reasons. I count myself maybe as one of them, a very few opportunities to be physical, but when it comes to the winter months, you need to make the choice whether to actually walk home or walk to a place, or whether you do something that's feel is safer. Can I come to Kate about how we tackle that, and then Cecilia to back up?
Yes, and I think we all know that women are in general less physically active than men, and I think everyday walking is one of those things that has the potential to be absolutely transformational in terms of moving a huge number of people from not being sufficiently physically active to get those health and mental physical health benefits to being sufficiently physically active. It's something that we can do every day as part of our routines. It doesn't take a lot of time, it doesn't take equipment, it doesn't take new learning. But we have this problem where women feel less safe simply walking to work, girls walking to school. The issues around it, I think, are very complex, because there's a lot around perceptions of safety as well as actual safety, and the way that women and girls are trained to take responsibility for our safety and to be blamed for any lack of safety. So there's a lot to be said about how we change the talk around women's physical safety in public spaces. But there is also a lot to be said about changing the facts about how we as women and girls experience public space. So, yes, harassment needs to stop. It needs to be taken seriously at every level. And that is work for men and boys to do as much as it is for women and girls to do. The other thing is, and I'm going to come back to this every time you come to me, I'm going to talk about design and planning.
That's why we invited you, Kate.
Superb. So when we choose to walk or not to walk, we are making an assessment of the space that we're going to walk through. And there are different assessments made by different people. One of the things that women and girls will look at is who is there, but also who's there who might potentially be a problem, but who is there to safeguard them. So things like passive surveillance, which is, if you're walking through a space, might people be looking out of their window and seeing anything bad that might happen to you. That's extremely important in women and girls and others who experience disproportionate harassment when they're making a safety assessment of the places they're walking through. We need that lens to be represented every time a new street, a new development, a new active transport route is planned. So we need to make sure that we are doing, the people who are doing the work are competent to make that assessment, whether that is their own training, whether that is through rigorous consultation, whether that's through doing a quality impact assessment adequately, which in this area is absolutely not done. It's absolutely not done. There's huge amounts of evidence that equality impact assessment around planning is appalling, you know, inadequate to meet basic standards. So we, yes, right. So harassment in public places can be built in and we can build it out. But we can also, we also need to be talking about behavioural change around how women are treated. We are entitled to be safe in every space that we want to go to. And that is work for women and girls to do in terms of asserting that right and, for example, you know, reporting harassment. But it is primarily work for those who are carrying out the harassment to do to stop it.
Thank you. And can I bring in Cecilia?
Yeah, so I was going to mention some of the things that Kate's mentioned about safer infrastructure. So more women report closer passes by cars when they're out cycling. That's quite a lot of evidence about that. Segregated cycle infrastructure would help that situation. Better lighting in areas where public spaces where women and girls might be walking at night. And as Kate's mentioned, passive surveillance, so eyes on the street, where it's possible to have places overlooked by other buildings, so that there's more vigilance in natural vigilance in that area.
Mm-hmm. I mean, and I'll come to colleagues in a minute, but just thinking about the one time that I took my bike in from my village outside Aberdeen into the college that I used to work in, the cycle paths were really not meant for the commute, they were meant for leisure, so they went down by the river. And you just think, at winter time, but there's no houses about, you wouldn't take, you know, you wouldn't put yourselves in that. So that speaks to what you were saying about the path's been built, was segregated, but also in places covered, yeah. and places that actually there's more infrastructure around them as well. You see, I mean, I see that in Aberdeen City. You must see that across the whole of Scotland.
Yeah, there is evidence that that some cycle paths do feel very unsafe and are very unsafe if they're not being used by a lot of people. And that happens at late at night, in the dark, in winter months.
Yeah, thank you. I want to bring in, I think, Ewan, you want to come back in?
Yeah, thank you. Off thread here slightly, but I just want to come back, I suppose, and the points were made around dissatisfaction of response, and that, I mean, I would, Kirsty highlighted very well, typically what happens in the governing body from a club and a membership point of view, if clubs are expected to have codes of practice in place, they are expected to have wellbeing and protection officers in place, they do have behaviours that are expected, and there are corporate governance sides that governing bodies would expect clubs to behave and have in place to make sure complaints are handled appropriately, concerns are able to be raised, etc. So these things are in place across governing bodies. So from a membership point of view, club membership point of view, these things do exist. And as Kirsty has highlighted, on certain occasions where issues or concerns are raised, they are managed and dealt with a leisure trust or with the council, if that's appropriate. So my question directly back is, what do you expect if that's not a satisfactory answer?
Okay, thank you. Can I come to Paul Sweeney on this issue of safety and harassment?
Yeah, certainly. I think a major factor in all of this, convener, is planning, and an important part in making women and girls feel safe. And I know that Such Trans evidence cites that just 39% of women in Scottish cities feel safe cycling in their area, for example. Planning can be a male-dominated space, it can often be a very confrontational and kind of egocentric space in many ways. So do Living Street Scotland and Such Trans have any suggestions on how we can make sure that gender concerns are considered and that women are adequately consulted in planning decisions in an area like active travel, particularly with respect to the new development plans that were drawn up by local authorities in the wake of NPF 4?
Yes, certainly.
Should have directed that. Apologies.
So we did some research a little while ago on the use of equality impact assessment in planning at a local level. And what we found was, so the national guidance is great. It embraces inequality. The further you get to literal street level, the closer you are to street level, the less likely it is that there will be adequate equality impact assessment done. We looked at 20 specific, it was either things like snow clearing plans or it was for specific developments. We found 4 equalities impact assessments that were available for those 20 projects. We found, for example, an example where a project had gone to a planning committee. It wasn't a planning committee, it was a regeneration committee. The paperwork asked the council worker, has the required equalities impact assessment been done? No. Went straight through the committee. So at the moment, the powers that are available, the requirements that are stipulated, are not being met at even the most basic level. Mm. Planning committees could up their game and require that this kind of work is done. But there is also very much a role for both initial training of those working in planning. That will take time to come through, so we also need to hit continuing professional development hard. We need to make a generational change in planning because there is a lack of cultural competence, I think it's possible to say, in planning, of understanding of equalities. So the point about public sector equality duty is equalities impact assessment is supposed to be done by the people who are doing whatever the project is. But that's not being done, and they do not demonstrate an understanding of what that would involve. Mm.
Just wondered if you had any ways of trying to codify this so that there's more clear rules and design for urban spaces, and whether there are exemplars that could then be just created as national standards.
You know, I think the national standards are in many cases fine. It's the fact that they're being ignored that's the problem.
Right. That's interesting.
Cecilia, I don't know if you wanted to come in on this.
I was just going to mention that we've got figures that show that only 13% of UK transport professionals report that they always consider gender in their day-to-day work, whereas 46% never consider it and 41% somewhat consider it. And then in Scotland, transport has the lowest proportion of women represented in senior positions within the public sector, so it's 6.25%. And that carries on, or that has the knock-on effect of gender perspectives not really being considered. And so in terms of involving more women in transport planning is the way forward. Mm.
Sounds like it. Emma, I want to bring you in on this. You want to come in on this specifically?
Yep, it's just a quick question. Thanks, convener. For Cecilia specifically, I've just had a quick look at the SUS strands, and there's toolkits about creating better spaces, and safety is mentioned, but it's safety about reducing the speeds of cars. Mm-hmm. But the toolkits don't seem to specifically look at considering planning for safety as in protection or support for women. Am I missing that, or is it just something that, in the toolkits and in the information, it doesn't seem to mention that? Am I just missing it?
We've got some research underway at the moment about safety in public space, so it's not appeared in the toolkits just yet.
OK.
So that's underway.
OK, thanks.
Thank you. Sandesh, you wanted to come in on this specifically before
Thank you, Vina. I wanted to come in specifically about mobile phones that was raised earlier. With more and more people taking videos in the gym, and I'd imagine in other places as well, and posting it online, directly, I think, to Kirsty and Patrick, but obviously if anyone else wants to come in, do you have a specific social media policy when it comes to your spaces? Because I do think that can make people feel very uncomfortable.
We'll go to Patrick first and then go to Kirsty.
Yeah, we don't have a specific social media policy, but we have, obviously, code of conduct and management rules in and around what's appropriate and what's not appropriate. So, and a reporting mechanism beyond that in and around child protection and adult protection, actually, as well. And so that's in place. There's a real difficulty in managing that because people come in and out and, you know, they have their own personal property. and what they do and how they deal with it. And that's in and around staffing and training staff and making sure that they are challenging behaviours in and around those public spaces. So that's where I think local authorities, leisure trusts would sit with that.
And can I come to Kirsty? If you have anything to add, Kirsty, if you don't, just tell me.
Oh, well, just wanted to say, we do have a social media policy, but it's for staff, employees of Glasgow Life, so they undertake responsible social media content going out and manage our comments, etc. So therefore, we have it for staff, but I don't believe we have it for the public, but I can look into that.
Thank you. And we're happy to take anything that if you don't have to hand just now, if you want to follow up. Sandesh, I'm going to stick with you on inequalities.
Thank you. So one of the things I'm very keen about is knowing about, is if you don't know where you stand with the number of people from different ethnicities, it's very difficult to make improvement. So my first question is very simple. Do you know, Patrick, that your breakdown of people from different ethnicities?
In some of our elements of our business, we do. In some of our elements of our business, we don't. So I'll break that down for you. We have a number of health intervention programmes that are co-produced by Health and Social Care, where we have everything from which SIMD you're from right through to your protected characteristic. So in some instances, yes. In other instances, for example, a casual user using the gym or using the swimming pool, we wouldn't have that because there would be a pretty simplistic way about removing barriers to allow people to access. So you wouldn't be asking all that ream of questions in and around even some of those basic health questions to the diversity questions as well. So we wouldn't have it for our entire estate. Okay. So, for example, we have 319,000 people in South Lanarkshire. We know that we have about 25,000 of them on memberships, but there's a number of casual users as well, so that would be a real split, so not having.
Fair enough. I'm particularly keen to hear about swimming, convener, because I think there is generally a bit of a problem when it comes to ethnicity and people wanting to take up swimming. I don't know exactly why that is, but do you know the your ethnicity breakdown for memberships, and what policies are you putting in place to increase people participating in swimming who do have are from ethnic backgrounds?
Thank you. I assume that was for myself. So yes, I'll pick that one up. The challenge is getting meaningful data, and I mean that from point of view of every year we request the membership to complete equalities data, which provide both equally as Patrick's highlighted SIMD information and protected characteristics. So we do have some information, but it's not rich enough. I would suggest. To allow us to make informed views about particular measures we do want to put in place. We have revisited the particular questions that are asked on that membership return, which is an annual return, and that's currently coming back in at the moment. And the redesign is to be able to get more accurate information so we can put measures in place. Our tack around equalities is directed at the first kind of experience, primarily through the Learn to Swim programme in and working with our partners and trying to encourage as many people to get involved in the sport as possible. But the challenge we do have is understanding the user groups' needs and equally those who we can't reach yet about where those particular, if there are protected characteristics that want to get involved in the sport, what activities we do put in place. But we do work with a number of different leisure trusts and local authorities who support programmes which are put in place to pick up particular groups. But we do have challenges ahead, for sure.
Thank you. And finally, if I could go to Kirsty. What do you have in place when it comes to trying to promote Glasgow Life? When it comes to promoting women from ethnic backgrounds to participate?
Thanks for that. I think I mentioned earlier that in terms of February, the month of February, that was that month where we were promoting all activities around women and girls in sport. And obviously that was to include all people from Black, Asian, minority ethnic groups as well as people with disabilities. So we actively do and do encourage the promotion of all activities for women and girls, and in particular the Black, Asian, minority ethnic communities. I'm fortunate enough to have within my team a cohesion team that looks at an equalities team, you might call it that, who can champion and lead in the equalities, diversity, inclusion agenda. So we are very proactive in trying to ensure we promote the Black, Asian, minority ethnic communities in Glasgow and the opportunities for them. It's not perfect, but it's something we are focusing on as an organisation.
Okay, thank you.
Can I add that kind of little
bit? Sure.
What I would say is that all local authorities and leisure trusts would be able to tell you their workforce. In terms of the makeup of the workforce. And I think it would be important to note via the community planning framework, all local authorities and trusts will be working with their neighbourhood planning areas in and around the areas of community or areas of interest of those communities to work with local authorities in and around. And that may be women, it may be in and around a holiday hunger agenda, it could be any kind of agenda. And I think neighbourhood planning is one of the good ways to actually find out what those communities of interest require.
Okay, thank you. Paul Kane.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning to the panel. I wonder if I can ask about socioeconomic issues for women and girls in sport. We had a response from Lanarkshire Health and Social Care Organisations, which told us quite clearly that physical activity sport is costly. That presents a challenge at actually targeting subsidy and targeting access from reduced rates and things like that. It can make a huge difference. I suppose in the context that we are in just now, and particularly with local authority budgets being increasingly pressurised, I suppose I'd be interested in maybe Patrick's take initially on how can we do some of that, but with a reducing resource.
But what I would say is, currently we work with Lanarkshire Health and Social Care Partnership just now in and around social prescribing. Some people call it GP referral, some people call it physical activity prescription. It's all the same thing. In and around health health professionals, GPs, practice nurses, physios. Where at the moment, if someone comes along, anyone, and presents to their GP, they would get a four-week free pass. Again, though, that just knocks down the line, that element of, well, at some point you're going to have to pay. But again, working with my colleagues here and some of those other green space programmes, physical activity doesn't need to cost anything, as we all know. So I think that's a fairly obvious thing to say. I think the social prescribing is an excellent gateway, stroke pathway into that. And then there are concession schemes, and that is in and around, individuals being able to get some funding, or the concession scheme itself giving a discounted approach to it. At the moment, if you looked at someone accessing our facilities today, it would be £12.50 a month to swim every day or go to the gym every day. That would be our costs just now for an adult. So half of an adult price, which would be £25, a concession would be £12.50. So that's it in real terms.
In a previous life, I served on the board of a culture and leisure trust, and certainly the challenges and the tension I think we always had was reviewing that charging and the eligibility criteria for concessionary rates. I mean, have you found that a particular challenge, having to change the margins of that and maybe more people moving out with those opportunities for concession?
Very much so, Paul. At the moment, our concession is 50%, but with those challenges we're talking about down the line, it's looking like it's going to go up a little bit from the 1st of April. So that is constantly a challenge in the roundup.
Okay, thank you. I wonder, Convener, if I
could... Did I see Kirsty signalling to me that you wanted to come in, Kirsty? I'm just... No, that's fine.
I'm going to pose a question to Kirsty, if I may, just on a slightly different topic, but following on from Dr. Gohani's points about Black, Asian, minority, ethnic women and girls. I just wonder to what extent, Kirsty, you mentioned a number of initiatives in February trying to look at some of those areas. To what extent have you in Glasgow Life went and sat down and spoken to people from communities about their needs and about what could be delivered that would help, because I suppose the knowledge of the barriers, you know, will be most acutely and most correctly told to us by the people who have that lived experience. So I wonder, to what extent have you had engagement?
We have engagement all the time with our communities and specialist sports clubs and organisations. So an example we have a community sports hub. So in Glasgow, we have 21 community sports hubs that across the 23 wards, and they roughly have about 100 organisations, clubs of about 10,000 members. So we actually, the job of the office is to go out and actually find out what are the needs of the club, but
sorry,
also the community.
Kirsty, can I just pause? Sorry, I maybe wasn't clear. I'm speaking more specifically about women from a BAME background who are engaging or not engaging in sport. I'm wondering, to what extent does Glasgow Life have any focus groups or have engaged with, you know, Muslim women's organisations, just as an example, in terms of speaking about what their particular needs are?
Yeah, so an example we had is part of the February was the Women on Wheels. It's predominantly a women's group that's a Muslim woman. But I did mention beforehand, we have a cohesion team who are kind of tasked to make sure they engage with the Black, Asian, minority, ethnic communities. But it's not only that team, it's the wider team. So therefore, if we identify community groups and organisations, we will then go out to that community to find out what their needs and aspirations are. We work with all the things like Glasgow Afghan United, and we help them do a women's empowerment programme. So, yeah, we have significant staff on the ground who are in their communities, our 23 wards, to make sure we do can engage with groups that are potentially not, at this moment in time, involved in sport or physical activity. But so, yeah, but in terms of when you talk about the socio-economic challenge, you're absolutely right. It is a really difficult landscape we're moving into with cost of living, etc. But there are things like we have health walks, which are free. So we have health walks that are 54 walks throughout the week. They're run by volunteers. The majority of the walkers are female, at 73%. And also the volunteers are at 74% of are women. We also have closed walks, and closed walks are when we train organisations for them to take walks forward. So we might train the link workers and help the social care partnership. We might train up, Afghan United, etc. So we'll train up organisations that wish to be trained, and therefore they can then deliver walks themselves with their own communities of interest. That's a relationship we have with Pass for All, and it's been established for a significant length of time. So, yeah, there's provision in the city for free, but it is challenging, and we try where possible to also do targeted provision for people that maybe have challenges around that socioeconomic background. And a bit like Patrick, we do have memberships, which are full memberships, also concession memberships. So if somebody is on universal credit or income support or job seekers or pension and carers allowance, we then have a concession for individuals to access our Glasgow club, which we currently have 29,000 people as members. And full enough, the people that pay the monthly, the majority are, well, majority, sorry, 57% are female. So there's good information there that we're happy, again, to share about our Glasgow club and our 29,000 members.
Okay. Thanks,
Kavina. Emma, you had a quick question on this before we move on to talk about infrastructure and town planning in more depth.
Mm-hmm. Thanks, Convener. It might just be a question for Kirsty or Patrick. It's about wheelchair rugby. You know, rugby's really, really becoming, everybody's playing it. It's really becoming very important for women to take up as well. But wheelchair rugby is like quite a leveller, because disabled folk can play non-disabled folk, and you can have mixed teams, mixed genders as well. So if that's something that is growing or can be pursued, to basically really looking at level the playing fields and encouraging folk.
Yes, we already have a relationship with the city, and they have used our venues in the past, be it the Emirates Arena, etc. So we do have a relationship with wheelchair rugby. And have done so, and even a member of our staff in Glasgow Life is involved with wheelchair rugby. So we do have, as I sort of said, under that cohesion team that I talked about, we also have a focus on disability sport. So it's to ensure we have involvement of people with disabilities in any type of activity, And be it a physical disability, learning, we try to support all people, be it young people and adults. So we have and been involved, yes, with wheelchair rugby in Glasgow.
I think most local authorities will have a sports council, which is third sector, you know, committee members, volunteers, and most of them will also have a disability element to that. So we have that in South Lanarkshire. And our approach is going to be slightly different in that we're not going to go right in there with the rugby specifically. We're going to have a wheelchair multi-sport club, and if that could, because it could be wheelchair basketball or it could be. So that's going to be our approach. And our branch, they're called branches, the sports council branches, funded by the local authorities, actually are funding the chairs for that, and that will be in the local authority setting, and it will be inclusive to all. Anyone can come along, as you say, able-bodied as well as, mm-hmm. because there's often, especially in around the female scenario as well, a sibling opportunity there to bring along a sibling, which is great because you're right, it's an absolute leveller.
And I remember that there was an advert on the telly where it showed people playing wheelchair rugby, and at the end of the game, an able-bodied person stood up and walked away and joined them. So doing it with siblings is something, maybe it's a question for the media folks when they come in front of us as well, to look at highlighting that.
Yeah, and for the record, I won't be playing it because it's really rough.
I know, it used to be called murder ball,
yeah,
and,
right,
and
right, yeah.
Now it's so, wheelchair rugby.
You can count me out.
Right, okay. Right, are most heavily subscribed in terms of members? I wanted to ask questions. Sorry, my clerk has just reminded me that I completely and utterly ignored that Luke Ewan wanted to come in before we move on. Ewan, apologies, and you come.
Thanks again, and I suppose sticking with that inequalities piece and the question that's raised, and I can probably share a view from sitting outside a council or a leisure trust around the biggest thing that's probably going to be facing the leisure and physical activity sector from an inequalities point of view is affordability and cost. And that obviously is related to the circumstance and that we're having to endure as a country at the moment. And it is, I mean, we're picking up signals from our sports, we're swimming, to our clubs, that they are preparing for increased costs to their access to any particular venue, to the region of some of the region of between 10-15% for some and more in others. One example last week was a particular area who was going to increase the club let costs for their members by the stage of 107%, it would work out at. So their club fees would increase from £33,000 per year to well over £60,000 per year, which is just not affordable. So these are pressures which are coming to operators because they have to have some affordability themselves to be able to provide the service. And that, unfortunately, with increased costs, is going to be passed on to members of the community at some point. And I think that's going to be one of our biggest challenges we're going to face from an equalities point of view going forward, is simply affordability. And from our own sport point of view, when we are one of the country's top participation sports with a high percentage of females involved in that particular activity, either through the membership or through recreational participation, when you start to see pools closing, that will have an impact on the health and well-being of the communities and the country at large. So I think that's something we need to be mindful of, I suppose, yeah, is just affordability.
I'm going to push you on that as well, because we had a conversation offline about this, is that swimming is one of the physical activities and sports that women do in later years as well. So would you agree with me that this particularly be a problem for older women who might not be doing high impact stuff, but would actually be swimming right up until their later years?
I would, and I say that because of the uniqueness of the properties of water, and it does have weight bearing properties, if you like, so that makes it quite accessible to genuinely all ages, all abilities, whether there's from the elderly to the infirm, to people recovering from injury, to those who haven't got any alternative other form of physical activity, and because they are unable to access or unable to take part in any type of activity. Being in water provides a number of different unique properties which allows people to be physically active. And in particular, the kind of proportion of girls and women who take part in activity, it's a concern when you start to see the threat of pool closures ahead.
Thank you. Right, we have a lot of members wanting to ask questions on facilities, infrastructure and town planning. So bear in mind that we have only got 25 minutes left and we have another thing to get to as well. So I'm going to bring in David Torrance, followed by Gillian Mackay.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to everybody. How could community sports facilities be better improved to allow female participation? The reason I'm going to come at is just examples like booking times, when it makes it a lot safer for them, because a lot of these community facilities had long-term male bookings, and as participation in female sport like football and that has increased, they found it very, very difficult to get into community facilities. So how could we improve this?
I'm not sure I understand your question. Do you mean, because I think most facilities these days will be online, the booking facility, so that's really equitable. Is that...
A lot of these clubs, especially like when I play with Watton Football, we've had long-term and we're at a time is very accessible to us all, whereas any other groups, especially female groups coming in, they're getting the real late times at night, the 9 or the 10 o'clock bookings.
That's not my understanding of what's out there just now. As I say, you know, if you're talking about club lets and casual bookings, it's very equitable that anyone could book online to do that. So I don't see that being... I think I know what you mean in terms of traditional... We'll get 10 taxi drivers at the John Knight Sports Centre in East Kilbride, and they've got the 6 o'clock slot, and they have had for 25 years. Yeah. But they still need to go ahead and try and book that on an annual or 12-week basis.
And especially around local authority community centres, where in many cases at weekends they are shut, and participation from these groups find it very, very difficult to get facilities like that.
Yeah, I'm sorry, I disagree. I don't think that's an issue for accessibility and people being able to get the slots that they would like or want.
I'd probably disagree when they come to Fife Council. The best example I could give is when you're off for summer holidays for 7 weeks, all our community halls are shut.
Not in South Lanarkshire.
So how do you actually get women to participate in sports, especially when it's a good weather?
Yeah, that's really challenging if the facility's closed. But I think, and certainly Kirsty can speak as well, but we have a 52-week the year operation, 6 in the morning till 10 at night in most sites. And, you know, that the availability is there to book slots and go and do physical activity. I can only speak.
Go to Kirsty and see what the situation is in Glasgow.
Yeah, what we also have in place in Glasgow as part of my team, we have kind of community venue programmers. So ideally, if an organisation has come to us, like a sports club or a woman, and they're looking for a particular time or slot, the programmers look across the estate to try and find a suitable venue at a suitable time. And also it might mean we're moving somebody out of a venue to something else, because that space would be better used by that group of organisations. So you might say, yes, if there was a young men playing football at peak time, but the kids were going to be playing at 9 o'clock at night, well, that's not good use of the space and time. So therefore, there would be negotiations and conversations had with organisations to try and programme our venues more equitably moving forward. So we do, as I say, have people that look at that. It is important. But yes, there can be challenges, because some people have had lets for a significant amount of years, and they're not necessarily wanting to budge, but we try and do it through our programmers to make sure it is, as I say, an equitable approach. But it can be difficult. In terms of Glasgow Life, our sports venues, like Patrick said, are open pretty much 52 weeks of the year, morning to night. So hopefully we can find availability for people.
Could I bring in Gillian Mackay?
Thanks, Convener. I know everybody else will talk about the sort of physical buildings and things like that, but I wanted to cover the sort of social infrastructure that we need for people to actually be able to have time to be active. I think that comes back to something that Kate said earlier about if you're trying to drop the kids off at school, do the shopping, come back, when have you actually got time to go and take that meaningful either walk, cycle, go and participate in a class in a local authority setting and things as well. Everybody might not have an answer in terms of their own work experience, but I wondered if anyone had a reflection on what changes we need to make. For example, we're my party are big advocates of a four-day working week, allowing people more time to focus on things that are important to themselves. We need to look at caring time and things as well. Does anyone have thoughts on some of those social infrastructure pieces that we need to facilitate women and girls being able to have time to take care of themselves?
If I go to Kate and then to Patrick.
Yes, I mean, it's an enormous question, and it does involve addressing things like care burden, mm-hmm. and you know, how households are structured. It goes right to the very root of everything that we do every day. I think simple things like, actually, you can travel actively to work if you've got time to get there via active travel or via public transport, which is actually a huge facilitator of active travel, because very few people have the bus stop outside their house and outside their work. So if, for example, you have to drop your kids off at 8:50, which is usually when primary schools start, and you have to be at work at 9, that is not generally something that's feasible. So, for example, we need to be talking about things like, you know, softer starts to the working day, so that actually, you know, you can work more flexibly so that you can do that. But yes, I think a lot of it is actually around not just changes so that things are structured more equitably, so women and girls do have that space in their lives that men can often take for granted, mm-hmm. But also understanding that there will always be people who struggle to find that space in their mm-hmm. lives, because caring is a thing that happens, having children is a mm-hmm. thing that happens. Mm-hmm. So how do we build that social infrastructure? How do we build the working day? How do we build... I mean, this also comes back to planning, because actually, if your shops are a 5-minute walk from your house, you will walk to them. Mm-hmm. So social infrastructure, but what underpins that is physical infrastructure and very literal planning. So, mm-hmm. you know, a fundamental change in how we do everything in society. Mm-hmm. But
yeah. just a small just one for a Tuesday morning.
Yeah, we have a current programme just now that we're working with a Clyde Gateway in the Rodden and Cambus Lang area, working with two local schools, and again, not working in isolation in that we're delivering the childcare. So we're helping a programme, as I say, called Clyde Gateway, deliver the childcare programme, so that allows that individual to either work longer or even search for work. And that's a free programme, and that's just about to be scaled up across in one of the more rural areas, to pick up on your point earlier, because some of those rural challenges sometimes are even more exacerbated, aren't they, in that area as opposed to the urban area like Rutherglen Cambus Lang. So I think we put a report in along with the committee report in along with that, so there's some statistics in there. I can't quote them, but they are in the report.
Thank you. Gillian, is that you?
Yes, yep. I think so.
Can I bring in Stephanie Callaghan?
Thanks very much, Convener. I want to ask about making spaces for women and girls, because we do know that parks, play equipment and public spaces for older kids, teens and adults are currently designed around the default male. So it's really, really interesting to know about the Glasgow Feminist Town approach. And I know there was a great motion at South Lanarkshire as well about recognising unstructured play for older children, rather than just an activity for younger children. So my question is, to Kate, Kirsty or Patrick, have any examples of older girls, teenagers and women successfully co-designing public spaces where that's increased the use by women and girls? And certainly feel free to send in any further examples that you might come across there as well. But I should perhaps mention that I was a member of the Sports Council at South Lanarkshire, and that I've known Patrick Murphy too many years to mention. Thank you.
Thank you, Stephanie. I don't know who wants to come in first. Patrick, maybe
not
since
me
you were mentioned.
No.
I mean, it's a great question. Are there any examples of where there has been this co-design with them? It's not looking like it, but I'll go to Patrick first and then I'll come to Kate.
I'm not aware of, in terms of planning. However, we have some really good examples, as I mentioned, I think, in my first Babble Dancer, in around care-experienced children. And they co-producing some of the programmes that I mentioned earlier in and around active schools and leadership stuff. So that's the only example I would give. I will check for you, though, as well, in terms of the co-produced green space stroke other unstructured play areas in the South Lanarkshire area.
It sounds like Stephanie's already making some recommendations for the report that we're going to do. But Kate, you shook your head.
I'm not aware of any. I'm actually wondering whether Celia might have more to say, because Sustrans does quite a lot more in this kind of design space than we do.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Celia. Examples I can think of are not in the UK. So
there is precedent elsewhere that we can potentially learn from. Mm-hmm. It's something that maybe we need to factor in our recommendations around this.
It's maybe worth saying that we know from street design that it is economically much more helpful to get it right the first time than it is to go back and fix the mistakes that we've made. Disabled people, in particular, being brought into design spaces to say, please don't mess it up in the first place, is very valuable. And I think, again, when we're looking at participation in public space, that would apply too.
Yeah. Thank you. Can I come to a question from Emma Harper? Or not, Emma?
No, I'm OK, actually.
No, you're
fine.
I'm OK. I'll go to Paul Sweeney then.
Thank you, Convener. I was conscious that the leadership of South Lanarkshire Council yesterday called for the Scottish Government to consider the creation of a swimming pool fund, similar to that announced by the Chancellor of the Exchequer for swimming pools in England last week. Is, in the first instance, Unit Scottish Swimming, are you supportive of these calls? And do you have a view as Scottish Swimming on how such a fund could be used to improve facilities and support the needs of women and girls?
Ewan.
Thank you. In answer to your question, are we supportive of those calls? Yes, we are. And I've actually written to the First Minister and the Minister for Sport likewise to suggest that the Scottish Government consider following a similar route of two-phase, I suppose, approach, which is supporting providers and operators of swimming pools, particularly local authorities and leisure trusts directly, with some form of energy relief in the short term, but equally the longer term piece, which I think is a more active support that's needed, is to have a broader look at some of the net zero requirements and ambitions of the current government to invest in the infrastructure properly over the long term to secure leisure facilities and swimming pools.
Thank you very much. I just wondered if Mr Murphy might have a view on why South Lanarkshire took that step.
Because of the current circumstances, I mean, our operating budget is £38 million for everything that we do, from the zoo right through to the 9 swimming pools and golf courses. Of that, we bring in about £18 million. The other 18 is the funding from the council, which is constantly reducing. And again, I'll mention that that doesn't work moving forward, especially in around some of the things that Paul was talking about, some of the pressures in and around our communities and how they want to access and use our facilities. All of these things coming together, it's so we absolutely support some sort of relief which would allow us to move forward and allow us to keep people using our facilities, especially women and those from vulnerable backgrounds.
Okay. And keeping those facilities open, apologies Paul, but keeping those facilities open is also about making them sustainable as well. And I probably want to press you in on this, because we've seen that there's areas in the UK where they're doing something different about how they're heating pools. I mean, this is an opportunity potentially. As I say, it builds into equalities. More women swim right up until the end of their lives than any other sport, but they're also very costly to keep open. But if we do something in a sustainable space, we could possibly do that. Ewan, I'll throw back to you.
Yeah, thanks. Just for example, for the committee, I do understand that in some areas some operators are facing a doubling, if not tripling, of their energy costs associated just with swimming pools alone. Probably no surprise, is one of the higher energy users currently. Of a leisure side, but there is rapid increases in tech and investment in renewables, which will reduce. The example you're talking about there, Convener, is as a data hub company who are effectively storing data, and if it understands this, it exudes a lot of heat. So that heat is actually being put to good use to heat the water, like in a swimming pool, and that has been evidenced down south that is working. There are a number of other sites from passive house technologies that are being developed, and examples being used to from the whole pool design, the whole building design, and energy use from air temperature to circulation to plant room, if you like, for that example of heating water, to also to filtration and use of chemicals, which are all advancing to reduce energy costs, full stop. So this technology is there, and there's an opportunity to invest in that.
Great. I wanted to get that on the record because that technology is very exciting and could be an answer to quite a lot of problems. Tess, you want to come in on that?
I mean, if I can just build on that, and for the reasons that have been mentioned why it's so important, is this something, finding the technologies, whether it's solar panels on the roof or the one that we've just talked about, is that something that Scottish Swimming can actually explore further?
Ewan.
Yeah, thanks, Tess. We've actually just commissioned a company to look at not just try and understand the actual landscape of pool positioning at the moment across the country, but map that against actual need for communities of right size of pool, right shape of pool, for those particular user groups and local communities. The third part of this batch piece of work we're looking at is to evidence and to provide some case studies of examples of renewable usage or new tech which could reduce energy costs for operating swimming pools. We're trying to get some case studies to evidence the government in a larger sense that this is worthy of investment. I am aware this is a world and European problem, and our European partners are likewise investing in renewables for particular leisure centres, and with that to reduce the burdens of energy costs for swimming pools. And this is an advancing sector.
Thank you. Right, we are rapidly running out of time, but we have a couple of members that want to pick up on good practice and the ways forward. Questions led by Evelyn Tweed and then Sandesh, and then we're going to have to wrap up, I'm afraid.
Thanks, Convener, and good afternoon, panel. I'd like to ask Ewan my first question. Emphasising the fun factor of sport is important, but with women's professional sport not being taken as seriously, it seems like there's a need to simultaneously work on access to elite sport if desired. How can the two things be balanced and not occur in isolation from each other?
To that, Ewan. Thank you.
Where to begin in answering that? In that question, from what I understand, and there is it goes back, I suppose, in some degrees to role models and perception. We are fortunate in the sport I'm involved in to have a number of very successful World Olympic medal and Paralympic medalists who are. Swim in Scotland, have lived in Scotland and are performing at a world stage in Scotland or from a Scottish base. And I suppose we're empowering those kind of role models. If I use the example I used earlier on of Toni Shaw, who's a world medalist. She's our ambassador for the Learn to Swim programme, which is, I suppose, part of that point of the ambassadorial role is around the fun and engagement and all the early experience of why you bother getting involved in activity in the first place. Tony is great at you know, sharing out that knowledge and experience she does have. We are mindful of particularly that fun and engagement point. I go back to reference to the young volunteer panel we do have. We are listening to our youngsters who are keen to change almost, if you like, or keen to put on other aspects of the sport which are less, I'm going to say less formalised competitive angles, but more of a, how do we just have a jumpers for goalposts engagement in the sport and enjoy the fun aspects that go with that. And there are other examples which have been used around the world. Goes from a changing the kind of profile of the activity itself. Was a series called the International Swimming League, which is a performance-based profile, if you like, for elite swimmers. But with that came razzmatazz, if you like, lights, cameras, different kind of social media engagement. It brought some more of the fun aspects of why people, what the things they love best about being involved in swimming to life. So there are probably opportunities of that side of things I think we could perhaps look at in the future.
Evelyn.
Thanks, Ewan. My second question is for Kirsty, and it's about ensuring good representation of women in coaching. And I think in one of Kirsty's earlier contributions, she mentioned coaching, but do you have any really good examples of good initiatives to make pathways to coaching more accessible?
I suppose I mentioned earlier the Energise programme we had, and that was about, you know, insight and training and support to engage and attract a range of females to a variety of activities that they would then deliver within their community setting. So that Energise programme was co-produced with the women that were part of that. And I did mention the fact that there was Activate Hers, so therefore they got additional training and support from my team in order so they can deliver projects, and we also put funding around that. But another good one was in terms of the mentor, and in terms of mentoring, we aligned people so they could share knowledge and experience and practices, so as to empower them and give women the confidence to take part in sport, but also deliver sport and physical activity in their community. Because there is a difference here around sport and physical activity. So you do have your traditional sports, and there are coaching badges, if you want to call it that, and qualifications. But there are all things we do around just the physical activity, like the health walks, etc., and we do training in that. So we have coaches and officials in our training team, where we try to identify women and, you know, young women as well to take part in physical activity and sport. Coaching. We also deliver with our colleagues in Active Schools a modern apprenticeship programme, and again it's about trying to get young women and young men involved in sports coaching and activity, and hopefully on a pathway to employability as well. So we have a modern apprentice programme that we deliver with our colleagues in Active Schools. So there are opportunities for engaging with young people in the school setting to try and get them into coaching, but also engaging with people in the community setting as well.
Patrick,
I do have to say that I haven't before, but we are going through challenges in the city, like ourselves, like Patrick said, in Glasgow, because with the pressure on the public sector funding and it reducing, it means all these fantastic things that we can do are at risk in terms of the moving forward. So it's really important that we do still continue to invest in these activities. Otherwise, we'll see a huge increase in health and financial inequality, not only in Glasgow, but other cities. So it is important that we recognise there's a pressure on public sector funding around sport and physical activity, not only for our venues, but for our communities.
Can I bring in Patrick quickly, and then I have to go to Sandesh for the final question?
Two concrete answers, Evelyn. One is in around, we have a dance festival every year, and there are 18 high schools in South Lanarkshire. They all come along. They're mentored by dance activators. They're young leaders, young girls. They go into the schools prior to the dance event, and they build capacity. They're volunteers. That's a brilliant example. The second example actually has a parliamentary motion, I'm told, and it's through you and our organisation, and it's in and around young people being identified to becoming swimming teachers, and this is a great model, isn't it? Because we've talked about those lifelong benefits. Young people being identified as swimming teachers, they're given a free, it's actually £550 to do your swimming teachers qualification, level 2, to allow you to teach. And then those young people go and are employed as well. So, you know, whilst university or college or whatever they're doing, it's a great model of practice too. That one has a parliamentary motion.
OK, thank you. Sandesh, final question to you, and then we must suspend to allow a changeover in panel.
Thank you. My question's for Kirsty. £17 million was spent upgrading Tullcross Swimming Pool, but it's now being closed with 8 other sites. What impact is that going to have on the community in getting women and girls into sport? And also, what are you doing to further improve the access for women and girls into facilities and into sport?
In terms of Tullcross and the impact, I think it was mentioned, as Ewan said and somebody else has said, pools take money to heat and maintain, but also the challenge we've had in Glasgow Life is in terms of recruitment of staff in order to run our venues. So post-COVID, we've seen a decrease of people applying for jobs we have that will do things like, as I say, pool lifeguards, etc. And a bit like Patrick, we're trying to do new opportunities to get people into training to get pool lifeguard qualifications and then secure a job with Glasgow Life. So there's different things here. There's a financial side that is challenging because it's the cost to run pools, etc., and also the recruitment of staff to run our venues. So there's two things here. But what we're trying to do to improve women into our venues and take part in activity I did mention beforehand we have a Glasgow club of the 29,000 members with predominantly, you know, female 57%. When it comes to developing these venues and these sites and refreshing them, we do engage women to make sure that they feel safe environments and feel welcoming environments. And what we also do is listen to women to see what else they want to get involved in. So we do things like group sessions and group activities. So you can go to the gym alone or take part in classes alone, but we also do group activities. So therefore, women don't feel they have to just, as I say, turn up themselves. So there's different things there. There's a financial side that's challenging to keep our venues open, but there's also then the staffing side that's a challenge for us as well. But we are trying to, when we do improve our facilities, engage with people as best we can to make sure they're inclusive as possible.
Thank you. Rapidly run out of time. We could have spoken to you for an awful lot longer. And if there's anything that you feel that you wanted to maybe have drawn to our attention that have missed, then we're quite happy to receive that. We're going to suspend very briefly to allow a change of our panel, but I want to thank our panel members for this. Thank you. Welcome back to our fourth agenda item today, which is consideration of an affirmative instrument. That's the Health and Care Staffing Scotland Act 2019 Amendment Regulations 2023. The purpose of this instrument is to make ancillary provision to correct some technical errors in the 2019 Act, which arose due to amendments being made to the bill during its parliamentary passage. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee considered this instrument at its meeting on the 28th of February this year and made no recommendations. We'll now move on to an evidence session with the Minister for Public Health, Women's Health and Sport and supporting officials of the instrument. And once we've all our questions answered, we'll have a formal debate on the motion. So our witnesses are Mary Todd, the Minister for Public Health, Women's Health and Sport. Welcome to you. And accompanying the Minister, we've got Sarah Cartwright, the Policy Officer for Health and Care Staffing Scotland Act Implementation Team. And joining us remotely, we've got Cecilia McCulloch, the Solicitor for the Scottish Government. So thank you to you all for joining us today. And I invite the Minister to make her statement.
Thank you very much, Convener. The Scottish Government is committed to ensuring appropriate staffing in the NHS and care services to enable the provision of safe and high quality services and the best outcomes for people using them. In 2019, the Parliament passed the Health and Care Staffing Scotland Act to provide a statutory basis for the provision of appropriate staffing in both the NHS and care services. This enables a rigorous, evidence-based approach to decision-making relating to staffing requirements and supports an open and honest culture that engages staff in these processes. Amongst other things, the 2019 Act inserts new provisions relating to staffing in the National Health Service Scotland Act 1978 and the Public Services Reform Scotland Act 2010. Implementation of the 2019 Act was paused to redeploy personnel and resources to the COVID-19 pandemic response. A new implementation team was convened last year, and the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care announced in June that all provisions of the Act would come into force by April 24. As part of the implementation work, the Act was reviewed and six technical errors were identified. During the passing of the Health and Care Staffing Scotland Bill through Parliament, numerous Stage 2 and Stage 3 amendments were made. And to ensure that the amendments were properly reflected throughout the Bill on some occasions, this required inserting or amending cross-references to other provisions in the Bill. In the majority of cases, this was completed, but in six instances, these updates were not made, and the Act contains these errors. These now require correction to ensure that amendments made to the Bill by Parliament are properly integrated, ensuring that the Act can be given full effect and the intention of the Scottish Parliament delivered. The instrument makes ancillary provision under Section 14 of the 2019 Act to achieve this. The first amendment ensures that the obligation on health boards and the Common Services Agency for the Scottish Health Service, commonly known as NHS National Services Scotland, to raise awareness amongst staff about procedures for notifying any risks they identify that relate to staffing levels under new Section 12IC of the 1978 Act, extends to all relevant aspects of that notification procedure. The second amendment ensures that the obligation on health boards and NHS National Services Scotland to raise awareness amongst staff about the procedures put into place for the escalation of risks under the new Section 12ID of the 1978 Act extends to all relevant aspects of these escalation procedures. The third amendment will ensure that each health board and NHS National Services Scotland must, under new Section 12IL of the 1978 Act, provide employees with information about how it's identified and taken all reasonable steps to mitigate the risks as part of the common staffing method. The fourth amendment will ensure that the Scottish Ambulance Service Board is under a duty to report annually to the Scottish Ministers under the new Section 12IM of the 1978 Act, how it's carried out its duties under new sections 12IE, 12IF, 12IH and 12II of the 1978 Act. These are the duties to have arrangements to address severe and recurrent risks, to seek clinical advice on staffing and to ensure adequate time is given to clinical leaders and relating to the training of staff. The fifth amendment will ensure that the Scottish Ambulance Service Board has regard to guidance issued by Scottish Ministers under new Section 12IN of the 1978 Act about carrying out of its duties under new Sections 12IE, 12IF, 12IH and 12II of the Act. The two amendments relating to the Scottish Ambulance Service Board will largely bring it in line with other health boards and special health boards, delivering direct patient care in terms of its obligations in relating to staffing. The final amendment relates to the review and redevelopment of existing staffing methods by Social Care and Social Work Improvement Scotland, better known as the Care Inspectorate. Under new Section 82C of the 2010 Act, the amendment ensures that the Care Inspectorate may, in a revised staffing method, require persons who provide care services to put and keep in place appropriate risk management procedures, and in the same way as it could when developing a new staffing method under Section 82A. stakeholders, including representatives from health boards, relevant special health boards, NHS National Services Scotland, local authorities, integration authorities, Healthcare Improvement Scotland, Care Inspectorate, professional bodies, trade unions and professional regulatory bodies have all been invited to participate in working groups preparing the statutory guidance to accompany the 2019 Act. And as part of that process, the proposed changes detailed in these regulations were circulated for comment and no objections were raised. So in conclusion, Convener, I fully support this instrument as the means of correcting technical errors in the Health and Care Staffing Scotland Act 2019, ensuring it can be given full effect and the intention of the Scottish Parliament delivered. And I'm happy to answer any questions that members might have.
Thank you. And with that, we move on to agenda item 5, which is the formal debate on the affirmative instrument, in which we've just heard evidence from the Minister. Can I remind the committee that members should not put questions to the Minister during the formal debate, and officials may not speak in the debate. Can I ask members if they have any questions? Emma.
Thanks, Convener. It's not really a question, it's just a comment to clarify that these technical amendments will help allow staff to understand that they can raise issues around risk associated with staffing or staffing concerns as we go forwards, and so that the staff that work in NHS Scotland, and I'm a former employee, I need to remind folk that I'm a former nurse for NHS Dumfries and Galloway, but these amendments will allow the staff to understand that they can raise issues around risk.
Other members as well, any other comments in relation to this before I ask the Minister to deal with them all?
Thanks. Convener, just I suppose a question in terms of these technical amendments had to be made, the tidying up exercise, if you like. Is it still the Minister's view that the timescale of 2024 and April 24, I think, from the Cabinet Secretary, is still the timescale to which the Government is working towards for full implementation?
Is there anything else that you'd like the Minister to cover in our summing up? No. Minister, can I invite you to sum up and then to move the motion?
So thank you very much. Yes, certainly we are still working to the same timescale, and in fact the working groups on implementation have been working according to the will of Parliament, so expecting these technical amendments to be made. That's a point that's worth understanding, and certainly to Emma Harper's points, yes, some of these amendments were absolutely intended to empower staff, to ensure that staff knew that they could what the process was for identifying risks and who they should report them to. They really are simply technical amendments which ensure that the cross-referencing within the Act is accurate, and that makes sure that the will of Parliament and the intention of Parliament is now in the Act. And if you're content, I'm happy to
move the motion.
Happy to move the motion.
Thank you. The question then is that motion S6M07988 be approved. Are we all agreed? We are all agreed. Thank you. And that concludes the consideration of the instrument. Thank you, Minister. At our next meeting next week, we'll continue our scrutiny of NHS boards, as well as taking further formal evidence as part of our inquiry into female participation in sport and physical activity. But that does conclude the public part of our meeting today. Thank you.